Everybody, hey, what's going on? Put down your cell phone. Stop catching Pokemon.
No, there's a Squirtle nearby.
Stop catching just one second. I have had to literally, John, over the, hey, everybody, welcome to the Rage Tech Podcast. I'm Jeff.
I'm John.
I have literally over the
Hold on. I got to get the Squirtle.
Over the last week.
Okay, I got it.
I have literally been recording, like, we sit here on the couch, right? We got the red couch here at Rage Select HQ. We're watching the TV. I'm talking. My co-host has been silent for a couple seconds, and I look over, and they're fucking catching a Pokemon. I'm like, could you stop for 10 minutes with the Pokemans? Because there's a podcast. There's a Let's Play. There's something going on. You stop for 1 second.
No.
Which is...
You're not the boss of me. My real dad.
I thought we had firmly established that I was the boss of you.
No.
We wrestled and everything.
No, we didn't? No.
Was that a dream that I had?
That was probably Grant or something.
Oh,
I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, that's true. I don't think I've actually ever seen you with your shirt off.
No, you definitely have seen me with my shirt off.
Oh, no, that's true. I've seen you with your shirt off a whole bunch of times. I actually have edited video with you with shirt off. Welcome everybody to the Rage Psych Podcast. I'd like to take this opening segment to spend about 10 minutes complaining about Pokemon Go.
And I'm going
to
talk about it in... And the other side, talking about how awesome it is.
You're going to say how great it is. Well, okay, so here's the thing. My phone is not good enough to play Pokemon Go.
Which is why he's upset.
It is literally why I'm upset. Well, it's...
Because if he could play it...
I probably would be.
He would be.
I probably would be. But see, here's the thing, John, is I'm not so much upset about my inability to play Pokemon Go. Which, by the way, well, just briefly before you can calm your fingers down... My phone is old, but I have an unlimited data plan with Verizon. As long as I don't re-up my contract, they have to keep giving me unlimited data. So it's like, well, I could pay an additional $50 a month for all the streaming that I do on my phone, or I could not play Pokemon Go. And at this point, not play Pokemon Go is where I'm at. I've got 8 different game systems.
Shit, if you sign up with T-Mobile, you get like a free year of Pokemon Go. No, it doesn't count towards your data.
What?
They just announced it.
Oh, Jesus Lord. So no, what I want to talk about is not so much my inability to play Pokemon Go. What I want is that, okay, so there's plenty of games out there that I can't play, right? Ark, Survival Evolved. There's got to be like one or two others. Actually, that's not true. I play just about every video game. Maybe that's why I'm so upset, is that like I have been excluded from this thing that is not only... There's turf, as near as I could tell, John.
Okay.
The other day, I was walking my dog, and we came up to this like T in the sidewalk, right?
Yeah.
And at the top, I was like walking down the sidewalk, and I was like, there was some shit written on the sidewalk, and I was like, what is this? And I didn't realize what it was. And it says like Team Fassbender, and like, and then on the other side of this little thing, it was like Team Canoe Face or whatever, something like that.
It was Team like, Mystic, Team Valor, and Team something or other.
Oh shit, those are the actual things.
Yeah,
that's what it says on the sidewalk.
Yeah,
do you join those in Pokemon Go?
Yeah.
And then
you
like,
choose between one of three teams: yellow, which no one really respects.
Uh-huh.
They're essentially Hufflepuff.
Okay.
And then there's Team Valor and Team Mystic,
because it was written on the in chalk on the sidewalk.
I think it's Valor and Mystic.
Like they were everything north of fucking Breaker Lane is fucking Team Mystic territory. And and then the third one showed up at this little T. Like everything over here in this park area is apparently Team Artichoke or whatever the third team is. And then I was walking my dog, and there was this car that was freaking my dog out, because it was this person driving down the street where I walk my dog, and the car kept slowing way down and sometimes stopping and sometimes pulling over to the side of the road, sometimes doing a U-turn. It was like some real shady shit. Like I got real nervous because... I don't know about you, John, but you know when you're driving and somebody makes 4 turns behind you and you're just like, oh,
yeah,
okay.
No, I get it.
I'm being followed by, you know, the ninjas.
They were playing Pokemon Go.
I looked in the car and it was like a lady and a dude. They both had their cell phones up and they're playing Pokemon Go. I was walking my dog at like midnight when nobody else was out walking their dog. There was like 4 other people out there walking their dogs, all holding up their cell phones. I think it's only a matter of time before this shit turns real ugly.
Yeah, it's Team Mystic, Team Instinct, and Team Valor.
Yeah, no, dude, they've blocked out my neighborhood. Like, they've carved up, they had a meeting of the 5 families and like carved up turf, and
I mean, that's so okay. So just so you know, what why there are teams?
Yes, please.
If there are
it to
Pokemon
me.
Gyms,
okay,
and you have to, and if you basically you fight as a part of a team, to capture gyms,
okay,
and when you capture a gym, basically that gym is for anyone who's part of, like, let's say, the Taco Bell that's down on Palmer,
right,
is a Pokemon gym. I'm not joking; it really is.
Tell me you've taken over this gym.
No,
tell me
I have
you're
not.
The leader of this gym.
I have not, because I have not been playing it as long as some other people. But I will tell you. I know you don't know your Pokemon, so it's probably not going to mean anything. But for the people who do, the leader of that gym has a really high level Bellsprout,
okay,
which is a flower Pokemon that looks like a bell.
Yeah.
Bell
mm-hmm.
is the leader of the Taco Bell gym.
Oh, I just got it.
Yeah.
I just got it. Sorry, I had half a beer. I'm a little loopy.
Yeah. So, but anyways, the point is, so that person is the team. So I can, as a member of Team Mystic, go to that.
You throwing up your signs?
I'm throwing up my signs. I can go to that gym and I can train my Pokemon, or I can even leave my Pokemon there to help defend the gym if some other team comes into attack.
Wait. You're going to abandon your Pokemon at Taco Bell like an errant crack whore mother, like way off into the parking lot?
Yes.
You just leave your fucking precious Pokemon?
Yes.
At Taco Bell?
Yes. But you actually... But every time you go back, I think it's like every 20 hours that your team and that your Pokemon is the leader of the gym, you gain like a shit ton of experience and a bunch of other stuff.
Oh, good God.
So you go check back like once a day and, you know, whatever. But anyways, the other teams will then come and they have to battle all the Pokemon that are of that team to take over that gym, essentially.
Okay.
So gyms are constantly in contention and battle and things.
Okay. I know that this is probably the crappiest idea that I've had in the last 12 minutes, but do they make such a thing as like a portable cell phone jammer that I could just like take out into the world and like then... Like, walk up to people playing Pokemon with my phone and be like,
if you
want to
be a fucking asshole.
I can't get this Charmander. I can't. What's going on here?
Yeah, if you want to be an asshole.
Well, I'm not an asshole because.
If you get a fucking cell phone jammer and follow people playing Pokemon and run a cell phone jammer, you are an asshole.
No. I am saving you people because.
Oh, no, go fuck yourself.
Because one of these days, you're going to be looking at your phone and it's gonna be like in Doctor Who, or take your pick of thing where there's going to be a big swirling pattern on there, and you'll be like, what Pokemon is this? And you'll be like, and then you're like, must vote for Trump, most. And then you're all gonna go zombie out to the polling place. It's gonna be brain control. It's gonna be like that thing in Star Trek, you know, when everybody's got the goggles on.
Yeah, no, Will Wheaton tweeted about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, he tweeted as
he
was like, I warned all you people, but you didn't listen.
I just look, here's the thing. It's a great idea. I kind of like it as an idea. I'm wondering how long. I've already got two news stories that we're going to go over about bad things happening with Pokemon Go. But what I'm wondering is, how long is it till I go to walk my dog and at that line where Team Mystic and Team fucking Taco Bell or whatever is, like, there's going to be a big group of kids all lined up with like Anchorman style with grenades and pitchforks and stuff.
I think that's just somebody being cute. I don't think there is actually any like battle lines drawn or anything like
that.
You
be careful, man. You'll get cut over in Team Mystic territory. Like,
I'm on Team Mystic. I ain't going to get cut.
I don't know, man. You're not rocking the Mystic colors today, so.
But my point being is that it's fun. It's whatever. I literally have my Pokemon Go for when I walk to work, and I catch Pokemon on my walk to work and stuff like that.
Who are you battling with?
You're not really battling any. Like, you're capturing Pokemon.
Yeah.
And then like you can trade your Pokemon back to the server essentially, and they'll give you candy to upgrade your Pokemon with.
But wait, you're not battling them?
No.
That's like 50% of Pokemon.
No, in this you don't battle. The only battling you do is when you're battling for a gym.
Okay, so do you have to like stand there in front of another person with your phone and be like,
No, there's no other. The other person's not.
So it's like asynchronous battling?
Yeah.
Well, that sucks.
Now, that's not to say they won't update that in the future. Like, right now, there's no trading and there's no battle, like battling. But there's always the possibility they could add that, because we already know that they've actually stated they're going to be releasing an update that contains the ability to trade Pokemon with other people.
You call me when you can battle in real time, because that's what I want to see. I want to see fucking people out in the streets. And the crazy thing about this is the fact that I have not seen a single child walking down the street catching Pokemon. It is only adults that seem to be out playing this game.
It's teenagers and adults.
I don't hang around with a lot of children, but, you know, when I walk my dog and there's people all over the place holding up their cell phones, turn around in a circle, I know what they're doing now. And they all seem to be like 30 year old plus humans, 25-year-old plus people.
And here's the thing. I will say this, is that this part of I do, like I said, I yes, there are some things that are not great about it. Yes, there are going to be some things you're going to talk about in the news section that are bad or whatever. But I actually do applaud this because, A, I think it kind of – I think that – and I don't think they did this on purpose. I want to flat out say I don't think this was done purposefully.
Mm-hmm.
But the game was released at a point when everyone was just – tensions were really high last week with, you know, with all the cops murdering guys, the shooting in Dallas, like just all this terrible fucking shit happening all at once, and, you know, the internet being full of such vitriol and hate. And then comes this game that everyone loves Pokemon. Everyone loves Pokemon. And everyone has a cell phone.
Yeah.
So it's a game that allows you to escape kind of reality in a way.
Sure.
The horrors of our reality.
Sure.
And so everyone went, oh, I'm going to play this. Oh, this is a little fun. Oh, it's going to require me to go out. Oh, hey, there's someone else that's playing. Hey, you're cool. You know, we're both playing it. Let's talk about it, blah, blah, blah. And it's just people, it got them out of their house. It got them interacting with people. It a lot of good happened because of it, I think. Mm-hmm. I think it had the atmosphere or whatever had not, like, had last week not been the total shit show week that it was.
Sure.
I don't know if it I think it would have been popular. I don't think it would have been as popular as it is.
You're saying people looking for a break from the horror show that is
and this is something anyone can pick up. Doesn't matter if they're
except for me.
Well, except for you. But you get my point. What I'm saying though here, this is someone that anyone, like your mom, can pick it up, and she understands instinctively what it's doing.
Yeah.
Your dad could probably pick it up and understand, and not saying your dad specifically. I'm saying all dads. You know, your brother, your sister, your you know,
right?
Not your dog, but, you know, whatever.
Right.
And then, you know, also
my dog does have a better cell phone than me. He probably could play it if he wanted to.
There's also the AR function of it, where you can actually, like, you look for the Pokemon with your camera.
Sure.
Which my phone doesn't do that, unfortunately. So I actually am missing like a full chunk of what makes the game fun. But you can also take pictures of the Pokemon.
Yeah.
Like in, you know, like,
yeah, Brian Salisbury caught
a Rattata
yeah.
And so you can actually take pictures and you can share them, and people have had fun doing stuff like that. And it's just a way for people to have fun. And I think there was a part of me that wanted to think that, like, over at Nintendo headquarters, they're just like looking and they're like, you know, we're not supposed to release this game for another week or two in the US.
But yeah,
if you've seen what's been going on over there,
yeah,
maybe let's push it out a little bit early just to kind of give them something to not, you know, something to have fun, not bad. Yeah, something
that you can pick your phone up. And
I don't
it's
think
not
that's
bad.
Actually what happened, but there's a part of me that wants to, that would like to think that they were just like, maybe that's what, because there were a lot of problems when it got released.
Yeah.
With servers and stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So there was a part of me that was like, maybe they released it a little bit earlier than they were supposed to.
Yeah. I, last week, during all of that, I was like, it was literally an airplane moment for me, where I was like, well, it looks like I picked the wrong week to quit drinking.
Yeah, no, exactly.
And I, on Friday night, I went and got a 6-pack of Lone Star Tall Boys. I turned on Tokyo Mirage Sessions Sharp FE and was like, let the J-pop bathe over me of just colors and Japan, and let's go Believe in Yourself.
I've been replaying Saints Row 4.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, that'll do it for you.
Yeah, and
saving, like, the world.
Yeah, like, literally, that's all I've been doing. Like, I started playing on 4th of July because, you know, 4th of July, and you're the president. So what's more fucking patriotic than that?
Bro Force.
Well, this is also true. but I'm just saying, it's, you know, you're playing as the motherfucking president.
Sure.
You know, so sure. And plus, it's got Keith David. You know.
Yeah.
But anyways, so it's like I started playing. So I've been playing a lot of that, and then I didn't actually start playing Pokemon Go until this week. But
I mean, it seems like, I mean, as a thing. Okay, here. Okay. Let me ask you, some pointed questions about Pokemon.
Okay.
Because I don't know anything about it, and there's probably some people out there.
There are going to be a lot of people who are way more knowledgeable about Pokemon than I am.
Okay.
But
one, how's the microtransactional nature?
I have not spent any money on it.
Okay.
I don't need to spend any money on it.
Okay.
Basically, mostly what you're buying is Pokeballs. But the thing is that you can get Pokeballs without actually buying them.
You just got to go to Taco Bell. Well, you got to buy it from that guy I talked to. He's like, hey, kid.
Well, no, you get, so there are two types of like locations that you can go to. There's Pokégyms, right, which you can battle for, you know, to own that gym or whatever, and which gets you experience and also gets your team experience and stuff like that.
Okay.
Then there's also Pokéstops.
Yeah.
Pokéstops are actually a lot of places. These are the places that you are usually at stores or at restaurants.
Okay.
They're places where people congregate a lot. And so at Pokéstops, you can do a thing that'll get you like randomized items or stuff, and like you'll get like Pokeballs and revives and potions and sometimes, you know, like
why would you need a revive if you're not battling?
Again, you're battling at the gym.
Oh, if you're battling at the gym,
yeah,
but you're not using that in real time. You're battling against a ghost of the person who owns the gym. Okay. So you are actually like you're fighting another Pokemon.
Yeah, you're tapping to attack. You're holding to you're tapping and holding to a strong attack. You're also swiping side to side to dodge attacks.
Okay, okay.
Things. Like,
okay,
there is a battle component. It's just not like me and you can't battle each other.
Oh, okay, all
like,
right.
That's the thing. So it's, you know, so you go to Pokéstops and you can like there's a thing where you can spin it, this thing, and it drops like items, and you can do this like once every like 2 or 3 minutes.
Okay.
So if you're like at a play location that's a Pokéstop for a long period of time, you could spin it regularly and get like a whole bunch of Pokeballs and revives and eggs and things. And,
okay.
Fruits. And,
what's the do you know what like the microtransaction cost for like what does it cost to buy a Pokeball?
Well,
is it like a pack of 100 for $2 or something like that?
Oh,
or?
No. You don't spend money to get the Pokeballs. You spend money to get Pokecoins that you can then spend to
spin the wheel.
Well, no, to buy Pokeballs and stuff like that.
Oh, okay.
Like the only like if you're going to a Pokestop, you're not actually spending any money. You're just spinning a wheel and it just drops random stuff for you.
Okay.
So like I literally have not actually needed to get buy anything.
Okay.
I probably will buy something at some point, mm-hmm, because I'm the type of person that when I play one of these free play games, if I play the game for longer than a certain amount of time, I'm like, well, okay, I'll buy something for $10.
Right.
You know, I'll throw a little money towards the company's way. You know, and also this has actually been helping a lot of like small businesses.
Yeah.
Because they've been, you know, if they find out that they're a Pokestop, they'll go in and like the owners of the businesses will go in and buy. There's another thing that you can do at a Pokestop, which is you can place what's referred to as a lure, which is basically it can only be placed on a Pokestop, and it basically attracts Pokemons in drove.
What about one for my house?
So, well, you have to be a Pokestop to be able to apply it,
okay,
to launch it or use it. Like, I can go to a Pokestop and put up a lure, like myself, and lures do cost money, or you can get them naturally through unlocking, you know, just the normal unlock ways. But businesses will go in and they'll actually buy the lure, buy the Pokecoins, and then buy the lures. And then just every time, you know, it like lasts for 30 minutes. So they'll put a lure up, last for 30 minutes, wait a few, put another lure up.
Mm-hmm.
And this will get people to actually, because people are looking for places where they can find Pokemon. And they know if they go to a Pokestop with a lure, they can just sit there and get Pokemon will just start coming in.
Sure.
So a lot of people are going to restaurants or bars or other places, and these places are just they're buying you know these lures, which I'm now in the Pokestore here, so I can actually tell you how much stuff costs. So if you wanted to actually spend money on this,
yeah.
So 100 Pokecoins is 99 cents.
Okay.
There's also like 550 coins for $4.99.
Yeah, I gotcha. 1200 better value coins. Is you spend more money.
Yeah. A Pokeball, like a pack of 20 Pokeballs, is 100 coins. So essentially, if you wanted to just buy 20 Pokeballs, it's $1.
$1. Okay.
It's 99 cents.
Okay.
Those lures, you can get them in packs of 8 for 680 coins. So, okay, you know, you can buy a lot. You can get a lot. So businesses will like I said, restaurants will buy these lures and they'll always have them active during business hours, and people will just come. They'll come out to stores and they'll maybe shop. They'll maybe order food if it's a restaurant, because I know there's actually been a few restaurants I've gone to.
Yeah.
That we were like, oh, they're a Pokestop. Oh, they have someone has a lure. Well, that's cool. We're going to bust out our phones and while we're eating and talking and stuff like that.
Oh, John. Oh, it's exhausting to me. I'm just like, it's like a whole thing that's happening and I'm not a part of it.
Nope.
And, yeah, well, I don't know. Is it fun?
Here's the thing. So you know how when you play Pokemon, how when you capture a Pokemon, there's that, you know, how it does the little thing where the Pokeball shakes a couple times,
right?
And then it, like, you know, when you get that third shake, and it's like, oh no, you caught it, and it's like, yeah, there's that moment of like, fuck yeah,
yeah.
You still get that.
That's what it is.
You still get it.
Okay.
And it's purely that, and, okay, and it's I think it's fun. I mean, do I think it's gonna lose steam at some point? Probably.
Sure.
But you know, I think depending on how often they update it, it could have some legs that are longer than like a few months or something like that.
Sure.
But it just depends. It really depends on
how much they update it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I tell you what, we got a good group of news this week. But yeah, before we go in here, just really briefly, I wanted to tell people that I finally got a chance to check out a Vive recently.
Yeah.
At my friend's house last week. That shit's pretty hot. If I had the money, I'd probably get one. Room scale is actually pretty incredible, but I still think, which is, if you guys don't know, it's where you set up. It's the way the Vive works is basically when you put the headset on, there's like an area on the ground that you're like, that the game is like, don't get out of this area. And then you move around inside of that. So there's like Space Pirate Trainer where you're like bobbing and weaving and holding up a shield and shooting all around you and, yeah, stuff. It's actually kind of interesting. There's a real weird bit of synesthesia where when you turn on the, my friend who was helping with this. So I put the helmet on and then he turned on the two controllers and he put them on the floor. And when you have the headset on and you look down, like, there are controllers that look exactly like the controllers. So you can reach down even though you can't see your hand, and you can pick them up, and then they move, you know, one-to-one when they're in your hand. It's really kind of a weird sensation, yeah, because you're looking at the controllers like you would look at the controllers in real life, but there's no arms attached to them. Hmm. I played Space Pirate Trainer, and I played the whole Valve thing. I think Valve has like this little mini game collection where they have some games. There's one that's pretty cool. It's like a tower defense where you've got the little black and white silhouettes from Portal,
yeah,
walking along.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then you've got a bow and an arrow. And so you hold one hand out like a bow, and then you use your other hand to reach forward and pull back, and then you aim down the actual bow and arrow. Space Pirate Trainer is, I think, one of the ones that everybody's played where you get like two guns and you can actually sight down the guns of the things you're shooting at. It's like just these little drones that fly all around you, and so you have to continually turn around. And then if you take like your hand and you put it behind your back, you pull it back out, it's like you have a Captain America shield that you can hold up, so you can like turn it, hold it up, and then shoot around it. It's all very cool. If I had the money, it'd be great. It's just that, you know, you're talking about an $800 headset and probably for me at least a $1,500 to $2,000 computer to go along with it. So
maybe.
Yeah. I'm eating peanut butter sandwiches, so that's not, I can't even afford a new phone to play Pokemon. But if you guys, if you got a friend or whatever who's got one of these, I'd say go give it a shot. I'm really hoping that, I'm still hoping to see more full-on games and fewer, like, stand in this room and dodge experiences, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I want a full game that has VR support, not just one little experience. But I've already said that a million times. So, with that out of the way and all of our Pokemon's moned and poked, let's go to the news. And our first story is about Pokemon Go. No, I'm just kidding. It's about Overwatch. There's a new hero in Overwatch.
Yes, there is.
Anna got added it. Is she on both the console and the PC now?
No, she's not on. She's only in the beta for the PC.
Oh, okay.
So she hasn't actually been released yet.
Oh, okay. Okay. So Anna is a sniper slash healer.
Yes.
It's Farrah's mom. There's a trailer that kind of goes into her backstory, which is pretty cool. It seems like an interesting addition. I personally don't know if I would have put another sniper slash healer in because of the number of healers that are already in the game that seem, yeah, to work fairly well.
Well, but I mean, yeah, we kind of already knew that she was coming. Like, there, it was funny because everyone thought it was going to be a character called Sombra.
Mm.
And then everyone was assuming that Sombra was Anna Asari.
Uh-huh.
And it's not. Sombra's a different character.
Yeah.
So.
Well, it's pretty cool, though.
No, and no one knows anything about Sombra, so now I think the next character that's going to get released is going to be a character named Sombra.
I do kind of like, though, the fact that she's got, you know, basically a sniper rifle that can either heal or hurt. Like, a lot of her stuff are,
yeah,
like, if you shoot an enemy with it, it does one thing. If you shoot an ally with it, it,
yeah,
does another,
no,
thing.
Yeah.
So she seems, she reminds me a lot more of, like, say, like Lucio than Mercy, as far as healers go, where she actually has a fair amount of damage output as well. Like,
yeah.
A little video they put out for her, she's got a, what is this, like a sleep gas? She's got an ultimate that actually seems a lot like the ultimate of the, or seems like the Uber charge of the medic in Team Fortress 2, where her, yeah, ultimate is you can throw it on one of the characters and it charges them up for a limited amount of time. And then sniper, her sniper rifle basically can either hurt or heal. And then some other, like,
she has a thing that she can throw and it'll either heal or it will stop the other team from being able to be healed.
It doesn't, I don't think it actually heals. It either boosts healing, or maybe it stops them from healing, like, or stops the other team from healing a character. All of which seems like it could be really interesting. I've been away from Overwatch for a while.
I still play it regularly.
Okay. How's it doing?
It's good.
Yeah?
Yeah, the competitive mode is fun. It's, you know, I like it.
Okay. It hasn't gotten, like, everybody hasn't wandered off somewhere else.
There's still a lot of people playing
it. Good group of people. That's good. I like that it's there, and I really like it. But, yeah, speaking of Overwatch, I think you had actually said it, but in the trailer, in the Anna kind of announced trailer, there was like an old photo that had her in there that had two other characters that we don't know who they are.
Yes.
And they were also what looks like equivalents of them appeared in that first rebirth trailer or whatever when Winston turns
the recall
thing.
Trailer.
Yeah. And it's going through all of the character portraits real fast. So there's some speculation that it looks like we got a couple of that these two could be, you know, new additions.
Yeah, there was also a hidden message in the trailer. Like there was like a single frame of animation that had a bunch of zeros and ones.
Oh,
that when translated, it was in whatever language, Egyptian, Arabic. I don't know.
I don't know
what language they would speak. Because I'm you know, not educated.
Sure.
But apparently people actually, you know, translated it from binary to the actual language and then from the actual language to English. And it also may be a hint that was as well to new characters or something like that. Because it was something along the lines of she who holds the knowledge is the one with all the power or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember the exact thing of it, but it was like, people were like, well, is this in regards to Anna, or is this in regards to another character?
Yeah.
What is this in regards to? So yeah, there seems to be a lot of hidden messages and stuff in these trailers.
Yeah.
Little Easter eggs and things that might tell about what's going to be coming soon.
Yeah. So yeah, I think there was in this particular article, it mentioned that the lady that they show, it's possible this might be like pre Blue Widowmaker, Widowmaker before the blue.
That was a theory. Yeah.
And then the guy in the actual character portrait that they have, looks like he almost has Widowmaker's goggles on.
Yeah.
So,
hope to God it's not another fucking
sniper. Yeah. Other classes in Overwatch could use a little love. So yeah, Overwatch is still rolling right along. Next up, we're back to Nintendo.
Yeah.
We got some trio of, there's a few Nintendo stories here. Let's start with something that, like, the more I think about it, the more excited I am. Have you seen this thing, John?
No, I know what you're talking about, because it literally was all over my Facebook feed when it was announced.
Nintendo today announced that they're releasing the mini NES with 30 NES classics for $60. This is like, you know, those shitty old, like, it's an Atari controller, but you plug it right into your TV and it's got like 40 Atari 2600 games.
Yeah.
Basically like that, but it's a teeny tiny Nintendo. I love how small it is. It fits in the palm of your hand.
And it connects through HDMI.
It's coming with an NES replica controller that can actually be used on the Wii to play classic games that plug into the Wiimote. It's going to come with one controller,
they'll sell
HDMI
a second
cable
controller separately if you need to buy a second one.
Yeah, it's going to have 30 games. And there's a pretty decent variety. Balloon Fight, Bubble Bobble, Castlevania, Castlevania 2, Donkey Kong Jr., Double Dragon 2, Dr. Mario, Excitebike, Final Fantasy, Galaga, Ghosts and Goblins, Gradius, Ice Climber, Kid Icarus, Kirby's Adventure, Mario Brothers, Mega Man 2, Metroid, Ninja Gaiden, Pac-Man, Punch-Out, Star Tropics, Super C, Mario Brothers 1, 2, and 3, Tecmo Bowl, Zelda, and Zelda 2 Adventures of Link. So that's a pretty solid greatest hits collection. Some of those, you know, you can keep your Ice Climber Nintendo.
I was a little weirded out that we're getting Mega Man 2 and not also Mega Man 1, or the fact that we're getting Double Dragon 2 and
not Double Dragon.
Now, having said that, I fully recognize Mega Man 2 is better than Mega Man 1.
Sure.
Double Dragon 2 is infinitely better than Double Dragon.
Okay.
So I totally get that. But then I look at it and I was like, Castlevania 1 and 2, okay. Why not Castlevania? It's Konami. Why not Castlevania and fucking Metal Gear?
Oh, well, there's that.
Why not? You know, and also Super C, why not fucking Contra?
Well, that's, you know, they got to hold some back for when they put out the second one of these in 3 years.
True, but I'm just like, I'm like, Super C, why Super C instead of Contra?
Sure.
You know, that's, it's like, there's some choices here that are like, well, I'm a little question that a little bit, but I totally understand. It's cool.
You know, I love the NES just as much as the next guy, but I really would have been boned out if this was a Super NES, if it was a $60 Super Nintendo with a bunch of Super Nintendo stuff. Because
yeah,
I feel like that stuff holds up a little bit better than original NES.
I think that would be cool, too.
But
I hope that they eventually do it.
The one thing about this, so here's the thing, folks. If this thing comes out and I can get a hold of one because, I don't know, this is one of those things that I'm kind of excited about to the point where I might want to pre-order it. Just to make sure they don't make like 12 of these for all of Austin and then sell out of them the day that it comes out. But here's the thing. I'm almost certain that they're going to have HDCP turned on that HDMI port, and there's going to be no way to turn it off, which means that I won't be able to use it for capture. Because it's something that small, I have a feeling that Nintendo's the kind of company that I don't expect to do that.
I don't think that'll be the case. And I mean, the big thing is that these are all games that are available on the Wii U and Wii for the virtual console.
Sure.
So I don't see why they would do something like that.
I don't know. That's the worry that I have is that you can never, like, nobody ever puts that in their product specs, like ability to disable HDCP if you want to stream this stuff. Because I would love to get this thing and then just have it sitting around and be like, oh, do we not have anything to play this week? Okay, let's fire up some Super C, you know? Let's just pull whatever
we
got.
My thing is, for me, this is, you know, while this is cool, I probably won't buy it because, A, I either own all of these games already on the Wii or Wii U virtual console,
yeah,
or I own physical copies of them, and I have a Retron 5, which already connects through HDMI.
Sure.
So it's like, but for the person who is not like me and does not already have that, this is fucking awesome.
I think it looks cool. And for the price of a single game,
yeah,
you know, getting the hardware and the controller and everything, I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah, no, I think it's very cool.
Hey, next up, speaking of Nintendo and things that are cool, apparently since Pokemon Go has come out, Nintendo's stock has gone up 25%.
Yeah. Which is funny because apparently some analysis or some, business analysis or whatever actually looked
analyst?
At analyst. Thank you. I don't know why. I knew I was saying the word wrong, and I was like, "Could
all I could think of was the an Alripus joke from
an analyst."
Development.
Thank you. It was just one of those weird brain fart moments.
Sure.
So an analyst basically came out and said that they actually did the math on it, and if you have to think about it, both Apple and Android take 30% of whatever money is made from an app.
Mm-hmm.
So and then they've already kind of stated that the company that makes the game, Niantic, or...
Oh, yeah.
They probably take 30%. The Pokemon company probably takes another 30%, leaving only 10% for Nintendo.
Yeah.
So Nintendo probably makes the least amount of money out of anybody on this game.
I don't.
But then you look at their stocks going up, and it's like, who cares, man?
I don't know, man. I trust Nintendo to chisel out a better deal than that to just be like, no, fuck you. You're not going to do... Yeah, everybody's going to take a piece, but that, like, this is Nintendo. And if there's one thing that we know from the years, Nintendo loves money. They fucking love money. They didn't drop the price. They don't drop the price on shit for a long period of time. I bet they got a better deal than that. But anyway, their stock has gone up. That's great. Again, as always, as with every single time that Nintendo comes up on this podcast, I want Nintendo to be a big, powerful, heavy hitter in the video game industry, because I want Sony and Microsoft to have to try to fucking, you know, rip my attention away from whatever Nintendo's doing. Like, I want that NX to come out and be banging as hell. So, yeah, good on you, Nintendo. Good for you. But then the other part of my brain wants to go and slap whoever, just collectively slap all of Nintendo to go, like, it took you this long to capitalize on Pokemon on something other than your handhelds. Like, I know that it sells handhelds. I know that it drives. Like, there was a whole article, what, 6-8 months ago about how, like, the Game Boy, the original Game Boy, actually, like, got a renaissance in sales when the original Pokemon came out. But it's like, fuck, dude. That, I mean, like, not a, no, don't devalue your brand or anything. Don't pull up LucasArts or right. But from the inception of this thing, it's always been a handheld seller. I mean, you know. What's the rest of it? Pokemon Snap? Ah, fuck Pokemon Snap. I mean, hey, you, shut up. Pokemon Snap, I'm not saying it's a bad game, but like they should have made one of those types of games for one of their consoles by
Pokemon
now.
Stadium.
Pokemon Stadium is another great example of like who kind of cares. Pokemon Tournament is another look.
Well, Pokemon Tournament is a weird thing.
All I'm saying is that like you look at the money in the late 90s and early 2000s that was coming in from JRPGs, and that's what Pokemon was. Is basically a JRPG. You're walking around, you're capturing your fucking snakes and rats and garbage and whatever.
Rattatas and Ekans.
Okay, whatever.
They're not snakes. It's snakes spelled backwards. It's Ekans.
Okay, whatever. like, why couldn't they just make one of those for the console? Why couldn't they make like a one that you could sit down and play that's not on a thing? So I'm glad that you finally got off your ass and put Pokemon on something that was not a 3DS. Or a DS, or a Game Boy, or a Game Boy Advance. Now for the dark side. It's time for Tales from the Dark Side of Pokemon Go. So I have two stories here, and they're both tragic, but one of them is a little bit more hilarious than the other one. So as a public service announcement, folks, when you're playing your Pokemon Go in the middle of the night, and there's one in the middle of a parking lot, and you're all by yourself, Maybe let that Pidgey just pidge on out of there, because where was this? This was in where was this? All I've got is county names.
It was in Missouri.
Missouri, okay.
O'Fallon, Missouri.
Yeah, in Missouri, a story of people waiting for other people to come to try to catch Pokemon and then mugging them basically in the middle of the night.
Yeah, it was they would go to a Pokestop, and they would wait for people to come by to a Pokestop, and then they would mug them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, maybe just make sure that, especially if like your kids are walking around. I mean,
yeah.
You know, that's
the big thing is like you want to be in groups of people. You want to be, you know,
called a gang, John. You want to be in a big group. You want to be armed. You want to make sure.
I didn't say you want to be armed.
You've got your.
I just said you want to be in a group of people. You want to be with a group of friends.
Yeah.
You know, be responsible. Yep. Use the buddy system.
Uh huh.
You know. God. Why do you gotta turn everything so dark?
No, I know that you.
This ain't the Warriors, motherfucker.
I know that you love Pokemon Go because it's lighting up mankind. But I'm just like, dude. Next week, it's going to be the fucking purge out there. It's gonna be people with baby masks on with machetes, like hacking other people up at Pokestops, trying to become mayor of fucking the corner of my block over here. Anyway, yeah, this is shitty. I don't mean to make fun, but. Seriously, like, just, you know, be safe when you're doing this up.
Yeah, and also, it's like, this is the only story. I mean, this is the most high-profile. I'm sure it's not the only story, but this is the most high-profile story about something like this happening.
Didn't you tell me the story last week of some guy, like, stopping in the middle of the road to catch a, like, in the middle of the highway to catch a fucking Pikachu something?
No. What I'm saying is that of people being robbed.
Oh,
yes,
okay.
There was someone who did stop in the middle of a fucking highway
don't
and
do
caused,
that either.
Like, a 10-car pileup.
Oh, don't do that! That's,
You know, also, what was it? The Texas Department of Transportation. Their Facebook
great.
Has been putting out, like, you know, don't Pokemon and drive.
Yep.
You can't do both at the same time.
Yeah.
Which has been hilarious.
Except for the fact that behind it is people getting in automobile accidents because you're trying to catch an invisible thing that doesn't actually exist.
I agree. Not to be
a big shitbag about it. Because here's the thing is that there's this other story, and if anybody had died, it would have been horrible. But as it is, people got hurt, and that's only mildly funny. But I believe that this happened in California? Yep, Encinitas, California. Two people, not one, two people, walking, looking at their phones, trying to catch Pokemon, walked off a cliff.
Okay, there's a message at the very beginning of the game that says, pay attention to your fucking surroundings. The article you're looking at is actually, the picture is that message.
Is the message that's at the beginning where it says,
hey, watch what you're doing.
Yep.
This is just as bad as people, you know, there was that meme that went around that said, hey, if you want to, you know, get your, you know, because there's also a thing where you have to walk, and the further you walk, it does stuff for you.
Okay.
In the game. And it's like, oh, use the turntable in your microwave, put your phone in the microwave and turn it on for 20 minutes and it'll get you this distance. And
no,
that was a meme.
No.
I don't know if anyone actually did it. But it'd be, I'm sure someone did.
That's like that. That's like that.
It's
horrible,
like that's their own fucking fault.
That's like that horrible thing where what the I used to see from time to time on like message boards where it's like, oh man, my game is running slow, and it's like, oh, you need to free up some memory. Just open the game and then hit Alt+F4, and it'll totally free up your memory. And then some person comes back and it's like, ah. But yeah, don't please keep your eyes on reality at least a little bit. Don't walk. I mean, unfortunately, one guy fell 75 feet. One guy fell 100 feet. They're both injured. They both went to the hospital. They're both alive. Like I said, it would be tragic if they were dead. At this point, it's moderately humorous.
They have only themselves to blame.
They literally walked off the edge. They literally Wile E. Coyote'd themselves, and not one but two. They had to be walking like side by side, right? And they had to fall off simultaneously.
So these are two people that were walking together and not two different instances of it happening?
No, this is the same time, apparently. Well, I haven't read the actual thing. I'm reading a paraphrase of a story. Yeah, but the way that this is written, it's like two friends walking, looking for Pokemon, both walk off the edge of the cliff.
Huh.
So, all right, just, you know, I don't want any of you people.
Here's the thing. Like, when I'm walking to work, like, I'll have it out.
Mm-hmm.
When I come to an intersection, I put the phone down by my side.
Okay.
Walk across the intersection. And then when I'm not in danger of being hit by a car, I pull the phone back up. You know.
Yeah. No, this meant that. Hey. All I'm saying is...
It's common sense.
Look, Rage Select audience, you guys that are left, you're the diehards, you're the true believers, you're the people, and I love y'all dearly. I don't want to hear about any of you getting mugged, getting hurt, getting in a car accident, or walking off a cliff because you're playing a video game. I love video games just as much as the next person, but you should only be safe, be aware of your surroundings. Please don't walk off a cliff.
Yeah, and then there's the people that find a dead body. So it's, you know...
Oy vey. Was that a real thing? Oh Jesus!
So a bunch of kids found a dead body while looking for Pokemon.
Stand by me, Pokemon Ghost. Style.
So they were looking for Pokemon and they just happened upon a dead body.
Oh Jesus!
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but I mean, I've heard like ridiculous good stories. Like, what was it? There was like one meme. I don't know if it's a meme, but it was like posted and it's been viral or whatever about this guy. He's like, yeah, you know, I'm an average white male, and I went to the park this one night looking for Pokemon. Like, it was like the night that it went live. Mm-hmm. He was like, it's like 3 a.m. in the morning, and I went to the park, and I'm walking around, and these two large, you know, black dudes walk up, and they have their phones out, and we're all like, hey, Pokemon.
Yeah.
They're like, yeah, we're just like sitting there talking and whatever. Sure. And then suddenly a cop comes up. Apparently, someone saw a white guy and two black guys in the middle of a park with no one else around at 3 a.m. in the morning and called the cops. And so he was like, so first we had to convince the cop we weren't selling drugs.
Oh, Jesus.
Then once we actually explained it, the cop actually pulled out his phone, installed the app, and then the four of them continue to talk about Pokemon and play Pokemon Go in the park at 3 a.m. in the morning.
That's my hope, is that it's going to be bringing people together.
And that's what it seems like it's doing.
Bring people together.
That's what I think it's doing.
Well, except for the guy robbing people or the two dudes walking off a cliff. It was separating those guys.
Well, yeah. But I'm just saying, I hear more stories that are like that.
Sure.
Where people are like, oh, man, I went out and I made a bunch of new friends because we were all, you know, except for that Team Valor person, that fuck them or, you know, whatever.
I just, you know, nobody's writing stories on the websites that I look at that's like, I went out today and met four new friends. And we all played Pokemon.
I've seen that quite often.
That's
on a lot of the websites that I've gone on.
So anyway, be cool with your Pokemon. Just be safe and play Pokemon. Keep calm. Be safe. Play Pokemon. Make a shirt or something.
Pokemon on.
Yeah. All right. That's all the Pokemon that we're going to talk about for the moment. Next up, we got a couple of trailers. The first one is they put out about 7.5 minutes of. Call of Duty 4, Modern Warfare, the very first mission, Crew Expendable, where you and Price, or just Captain Price, right?
I don't fucking know.
Munt chops. Go down to this tanker and basically do the thing. It looks real nice.
It does.
Like, it's funny because I was actually watching, this is kind of the raw footage, but I saw this on somebody else's YouTube channel.
Yeah.
And they made this really prescient comment. I'm sorry, Guy, I don't remember what the name of the channel was. Who said that, like, honestly, the way that this looks is the way that you remember Modern Warfare looking in your head.
Yeah.
But if you go back and actually play it, you'll notice that it doesn't look anything like this anymore. It doesn't look near as good as this. There's a lot of really interesting little details here. There's little water droplets on the guns and Everything, it looks like it's had a real big facelift. Like, it looks really good.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, this is an entirely new game built from the ground up, and they just happen to try to make it as close to as possible to the, I mean, made with the current engine that they're using.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's not like they took the old engine and then HD-ified it. They remade the game from the ground up using the current game engine.
Right. But, no, it looks super, super good. I don't know. Like, it's one of those things that is that's a real shame about talking about the video game industry.
Yeah.
Because here's the thing. Activision putting this in with the $80 version of Infinite Warfare is just the dick garbage. It's Richard garbage. It's horrible. You should not make people buy Infinite Warfare if they want to get this without that. This should be able to be sold as a standalone product, and it's kind of shitty that you're not going to let people. I'd buy this thing for $30 or $40 all by itself, and so would a bunch of other people, rather than pay for it as a bundle with, you know, to bump up the sales of Infinite Warfare.
Yeah.
That being said, it looks incredible. It does. Fantastic. Like, there's just a bunch of, like, particle and lighting effects, and, like, I even like the way that there's some weird, like, warping at the edge of the gas mask that the character has on. So it's a real thing where I'm real torn, because I really do want to play this. I actually want to play Infinite Warfare. I don't have any problem with either this or Infinite Warfare. I just object to them to you having to buy Infinite Warfare in order to be able to get this.
I understand.
I think that there should definitely be an option to do it without. I don't know. Are you,
I get you,
at all excited about this?
Not really. I'm not a Call of Duty person. I don't really care.
Not even the single player?
No.
No?
No.
Okay. Fair enough.
I have no affinity for Modern Warfare. I have, like, literally, it does. I played the story mode. I played the story mode for Modern Warfare 2. I don't care.
Okay. Yeah, that's fair enough. Well, yeah, everybody's going to care about everything. Well, let's see. Next up on the trailer, we had a trailer for Headlander, a story trailer.
This is a Double Fine.
Yep, and a release date. This is coming out at the end of the month. And for those of you who have forgotten, this is like kind of a retro sci-fi. You play as a head with a jetpack that can connect to other people's bodies. But in this trailer, we learned that you're like trying to free the populace, the robo populace.
Yeah, apparently mankind has transferred their consciousness into robot bodies, and and there is a AI computer that is taking control of humanity in these robot bodies.
Yep.
And you are a human head that is the last human head in existence that is not a robot.
Yep.
And you can, using a special suit and a helmet, you can plug your head onto anybody, any robot body, to take over it.
I really like this trailer, John.
I like the trailer. The trailer, actually, it's kind of funny, because I said this to you after we watched. I was like, it reminds me of this weird amalgam of trailers for both the movie Barbarella and Zardoz.
You know what it reminds me of is like Tom Baker Doctor Who.
Yeah,
like the way that the robots look at everything. I also appreciate the fact that at the beginning this. Well, there's a spaceship in here that just looks like a cock and balls.
It looks like a penis.
And then not only that, but I don't know if you noticed this, but at the very beginning when they were talking about all this stuff, there was the boob tube.
Yeah, like everything's pleasure because they're immortal, and it's not called utopia. It's called yourtopia.
Yeah. But I really like – so a couple things that we could probably say from the trailer here is, one, it looks like you're going to be able to customize your head. Because there's a lady, there's a dude, there's also an older dude with like a mustache.
So it looks like you may be able to customize your head in some way, or at the very least have multiple heads you can choose from.
Right. I gotta say that, like, the aesthetic, the music in this trailer, the kind of just the way that the whole thing feels, it looks like a real fun game.
Yeah, it looks like a 70s sci-fi cheese fest movie.
Yep.
Like the two that I mentioned, Zardoz or Barbarella, or even the, you know, Baker era Doctor Who episodes.
Or like Battlestar Galactica. It looks real fun. It also, the actual gameplay sections look like they're real kind of peppy side-scrolling kind of adventure slash puzzle elements. So, yeah, I like this. And I think it's interesting that, was this announced at last year's E3, not the one that we just got done with, but the one before that, right?
I think that was the first time it was shown.
Okay, because I don't remember seeing
it. I think it was announced before then. Like, I don't think it was announced at anything.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was just announced, but I think they showed the first, like, full-length trailer around then.
Because it's coming out at the end of the month, and I'm glad that it is, because this month has been kind of garbage. So
I didn't know it was coming out at the end of the month, and I'm actually kind of looking forward to it.
Yep, July 26th. So not next week, but the week after.
Nice.
So, yeah. That's a good one. I would say go check it out, because it looks, you know, it also kind of reminds me, the gameplay kind of reminds me a little bit of something like the Swapper.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Yeah.
The kind of like loose physics kind of thing going on.
I see that.
So yeah, just go check out Headlander. It looks like it's going to be pretty cool. Next up. So apparently Star Wars is getting an offline bot match mode next week.
Oh, Battlefront.
Battlefront, sorry. What did I say?
You said Star Wars.
Okay.
So I was just clarifying Star Wars Battlefront.
Yeah.
Okay.
There was a blog that came out this week where they basically said that, like, you're going to have an offline option to play Walker Assault or Fire Squadron or some of the other modes with a bunch of bots.
Okay.
I mean, considering that, I don't think that's going to really, like, help the people that wanted Quotey Finger single player. I mean, even though the single player in, like, Battlefront 2 was a bot match, it still had a little bit more depth, where it had, like, rotating objectives that you had to go do. But I don't know. You guys chime in the comments, let us know. Does this help at all for those of you who don't like Battlefront? Because I don't know. Also, we know now that the next expansion, Death Star, will be out in September. I still haven't played Cloud City yet. I really need
I haven't played any of it because I don't own it.
A reason. Oh, man, you should have gotten it during that E3 sale. You get the whole thing. You get Battlefront for $7 on the PlayStation Network. And then you could get, I think on Origin, you could get Battlefront.
I think it was also broke.
DLC for, I think you get like $50 for the game and the season pass during E3.
Well, too late now.
Yeah, true. Fair enough. True enough. Yep. Next up, how about a little Fallout for you?
Okie dokie.
Fallout Shelter is now out on the PC.
Hey!
I think I'm going to try to get it into one of the dojos. It's interesting, though, because it's not on Steam. It's not on anything. You have to download a specific Bethesda client.
Yeah.
And I think that people that have been doing mods have to run through that already to get their mods into whatever. But it's the first time I've had Laysai, yet another like front-end client for a game that I will probably only use for this one game only and then never use it again. And I thought, like, I was like, after I downloaded it, I was like, well, let me connect it to my PS4 and my Steam account and maybe get access to those games on there. No, you can only do that from like inside of the game. Like, you have to literally launch Fallout and then go in and then go to the mod store and then be like, attach my account.
Weird.
But, yeah, I don't know. So if you have been holding off because Fallout Shelter, you wanted to play it on a bigger screen, you can now.
And now
do
you
that.
Have quests.
Yep.
You actually can leave your shelter.
Yep. It's got the 1.6 update or whatever it is, with all of that stuff. All right. Next up, we are back for week 3 of the CSGO Lotto debacle. Whatnot. So first up, this actually happened right after we recorded last week. CSGO Lotto website got yanked into that lawsuit that's going on right now, where somebody's trying to sue Valve over CSGO being a gambling, essentially.
Yeah.
So they got yanked in there in an addendum, which is, you know, whatever. But the other thing that happened was that Valve basically came out and said, these sites are using like API tools that we never intended for them to use to verify Steam accounts, looking on people's inventories and things like that.
Yeah.
These tools were not made for somebody to run a gambling website, and that they're now issuing like basically orders for those websites to cease and desist doing that shit so that they can't do it anymore.
Yeah.
I think you've been on since we talked about this, right?
Yeah,
was
no,
it 2
I have.
Weeks ago when it first started up?
Yeah.
What do you think? Anything changed for you since then?
I mean, it's shitty.
Yeah, that's pretty crappy. I do like the fact, though, that, you know, Valve is trying to disconnect themselves from this horseshit.
Oh, yeah, no, they totally are.
Why? Well, speaking of horrible companies doing miserable, shitty things, Warner Brothers got themselves a bit of a slap on the wrist. So for people who don't remember, back when Shadow of Mordor came out, a bunch of YouTubers were given early copies of Shadow of Mordor with very explicit instructions from Warner Brothers about like how to talk about the game, how to show the game, to not focus on bugs, to do this, that, and the other thing. There's basically like a huge kind of list of rules that came with getting these early. And then apparently some other people also got paid
There were some people who actually got like a large sum of money.
Yeah. And the FTC is now basically, they're kind of tapping Warner Brothers on the wrist for this and saying, don't do this again, because there was like, there was a few things. There was some verbiage from Warner Brothers about making sure that like your disclosure that this is a paid basic video should be put below the break in your YouTube description so that the person has to hit show more to get access to it. They didn't do a lot of due diligence as far as making sure that people were being very explicit up front in their videos, that this was something that they were, you know, getting, which I feel is kind of some bullshit. Like, I feel like there should be a little bit harsher of a penalty than just like some finger wagging and make sure that this doesn't ever happen again, because I don't know. Like, I don't like the idea of people getting paid. Oh, well, hell, it's one of the reasons that I hate the CSGO shit, right? Is those guys running a website and then like faking on their YouTube videos like, oh, we just found this website, you guys should totally check it out, it's super cool. Like, I want that to be full on disclosure.
So yeah.
The day that we get, you know, bought by Taco Bell.
You know, it's one thing if someone says at the very beginning, they're like, hey, this is a sponsored video.
Yeah.
You know, Warner Brothers has paid me to play this game. They have even given me a copy of the game to play before it comes out. So I am playing it for you here today. Please enjoy. Like, that's one thing.
Yeah.
But like you said, they kind of were told to do things so that it didn't, so that if you were just watching the video, you wouldn't know that it was a sponsored video. And you think like, oh, man, this person's like having this great time with this game.
Right.
I want to play this game, too. I think what sucks the most about it is that it's actually a really good game.
Yeah.
Like, if it was a shitty game, this probably would have, you know, found out more about this a lot sooner. But the fact that it was a really good game that, you know.
Yeah, that's the biggest head scratcher of them all, right? Is like, why? You just be like, just give people copies of it. Everybody's going to be hyped anyway because it was a fucking fantastic game. Yeah. Yeah. No, I agree. So I don't know. I think there should have been maybe a little bit more, but anyway, we'll always tell you here at Rage Select if we're getting paid off.
I mean, every time I've gotten a game from a developer for Super Awesome Video Game Show, I've been very upfront about that, like in the videos, like, hey, I got this game from the developer, you know, kind of thing. Like, I know we don't like, we have in the past done reviews, and sometimes we talk about mini reviews in podcasts and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But we've always been pretty upfront, like when we're given a game, like, hey, you know, like, hey, we were given this game for free.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I've gotten Steam keys for a few games out there. I think the most notable game that I ever got was probably GTA 5.
Yeah.
They sent me a copy of GTA 5. I've never actually been paid.
No, we've never been paid.
I would love
if you
that.
Want to.
If you, yeah.
As long as you're okay with us being totally upfront about being paid and you're a developer.
Or if you're not, but you've got some real deep pockets. Like, you remember when Aliens Colonial Marines came out and there was that one guy at that one magazine who wrote a glowing review about how awesome Aliens Colonial Marines was?
Yeah.
And it was like, you know what? I'll write your glowing review for Aliens Colonial Marines, but you give me enough money to retire, because I know that after this, nobody's going to trust the shit that I say ever again.
No one trusts it anyways.
What are you talking about, me? Ah, boo.
Gotcha.
Boo.
No, I'm just I'm joking. People trust your reviews.
Hey, man, that new Ghostbusters game, it's totally awesome.
Don't do that.
Four
don't
players.
Do that. Don't do that.
All right.
No, don't do that.
Who you going to call?
No, don't do that.
Woo.
Don't. You're not getting paid for that one.
It's terrible. It's terrible.
It's a terrible game.
That's what you can have, Warner Brothers, right over here. So, so the first Xbox One S kind of Gears of War branded Slim has been listed, $449. It's dumb.
$449?
$449. Yes, not $4.49.
You just said 49. That's all you said.
No, I said 449.
It's not like you just said 49.
I had half a beer.
Like you said, it's 449.
I had 8 ounces of Lone Star. Just cut me a break here. I'm not used to podcasting whilst in the bag, which I shouldn't be for 8 ounces of Lone Star. Anyway, it's going to be a 2 terabyte hard drive, 449. It comes with Gears of War 4 because of the code that actually lets you get into Gears of War 4 Ultimate Edition earlier.
Cool.
Controller. It's all spray painted red.
Yeah, looks like cool.
Dog shit, but... Oh, I don't know. I have a real issue with the themed consoles because I'm like, well, eventually I'm going to get tired of, I mean, you know, my console is just nothing. It's just a black console. I get the feeling that I would get tired of looking at this this big Gears
logo. Yes, because you're looking at your consoles ever so often.
I look at my consoles all the time. They're on a bookshelf.
Never look at my console outside of when I need to turn it off and turn it on.
Yeah.
Or put a game inside of it.
Yeah. How do you move it around? I mean,
I don't.
You don't.
Like most people, my consoles are in a like an enclosure and hooked up to my TV at all times. They are not like you, who has to switch in and out consoles on a regular basis. Sometimes takes the console downstairs.
Yeah.
Sometimes brings it back upstairs.
That's true. I guess. I don't know. I guess I just look at this thing and I'm like, I don't know if I want this angry red console forever and ever under my TV.
People, hey, but if you're a huge Gears of War fan, that's a great...
Maybe so.
It looks like a nice console. It's cool.
Maybe so. Speaking of Microsoft, guess who's not going to be at Gamescom this year?
Sony.
Microsoft.
Oh, okay.
That was a soft... Easy, underhanded pitch over the plate.
I totally missed it. I whiffed.
So last year, Sony pulled out of Gamescom, where they didn't have anything at Gamescom. And then Microsoft kind of got to do their own thing. And this year, Microsoft is not going to be at Gamescom either.
Yeah, apparently they're doing a fan event.
Yep. Which I feel like this just goes back to what I've been saying for a long time of like, I feel like these big trade shows are dying because you could just put on your own trade show for the amount of money they want for you to be at their trade show.
Yeah.
They're still going to be showing off games, but, you know, which kind of sucks because I want to see more Sea of Thieves. That's really what I'm in there for.
You could get some new trailers.
If you are looking to get yourself an Oculus Rift, but you didn't want to go and wait for it, apparently they're now shipping.
Yeah.
So you just buy one and it'll ship directly to you. I don't know. I still need more. I need more for VR before I make a significant financial investment in VR. Boy, we're just
you also need more money. So you
I also do need more money. Let's see. So last week Evolve had about 300 players. And then it went free to play on the PC with the Evolve. What's it? What are they calling this thing? Like season two or version two, stage two. And now they're up to 1 million. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah. Good for them.
Good for Evolve. I haven't yet to check it out. Do you have any interest in going back to play Evolve? No,
nope.
Not
at
even
all.
Free.
No, not at all.
Okay. All right. Who knows? It could be really good now.
It was good then. It just wasn't great.
Okay. Could it be great now.
It wasn't it, like I'm gonna be honest. Evolve was not a bad game. I had fun with it. I enjoyed it, but I got bored with it.
Okay, fair enough. Hey, that System Shock remake that we looked at on Super Awesome Video Game Show.
Yeah,
they hit their Kickstarter
goal.
In fact, they actually went a little bit above their Kickstarter.
Nice.
Goal. They were looking for $900,000, and they got there's still 13 days left to go, but they're at $1,005,000 right now. So
as of the recording.
Yep, as of our recording. Which
nice.
Is cool, 'cause
good for them.
Yeah, I want to play it. I think it looks pretty cool. You know what else looks really cool that's been kind of in development for a long time?
What?
Do you know what the game Quadrilateral Cowboy is?
No, I don't.
Okay. 2000, let's turn the Wayback Machine back to the beginning of Rage Select in 2013.
Okay. It was a long time ago.
This is a game that's like an 80s.
It was like millions of years ago,
it's
right?
So long ago. The PlayStation 4 was brand new.
You were like
Xbox One was brand new.
36 that year,
I
right?
was like 35.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah.
How old are you now? Like 50?
38. Yeah, like 1 million. Something like that. Okay, so this
I'm trying
game,
to make an old joke.
I know.
Your old joke.
No, I know. It's real easy. But I'm old, so I'm not picking up on it, right?
That's oh, okay. That's you're not picking up what I'm putting down, I guess.
This is like a stealth... It's like an 80s themed stealth game where you have a laptop and you're like sneaking into a building and you're plugging the laptop in. But the kind of the twist on it is that it makes you write actual code, is that it brings up the code of like that door or that switch or like these laser fields. And then you have to actually go in and like retype the stuff. So it's like a that's the way that I remember being the last time that I looked at it. So it's kind of this retro futuristic programming simulator slash stealth game. And it looks really cool, and I've been waiting for it forever. It was an IndieCade game in 2013, and it finally has a release date. The same time as Headlander, the end of July.
So, July 25th.
Yep. I'm looking forward to that. You will definitely be seeing that somewhere on Rage Select. And last but not least, when it comes to games that are getting made, getting put out, getting finished, getting whatever, last week, this was came out right after we finished our podcast. No Man's Sky has gone gold.
Hey!
So there you go. Which I...
That means they're not going to push it back again.
Yes.
Maybe.
Is there any way that that No Man's Sky can live up to the hype?
I don't know.
The hype has reached fairly unreasonable
proportions. I think the hype kind of died after the delay.
Oh, did it?
Yeah.
After the whole death threats delay thing?
Yeah, I think the hype kind of... It died.
Okay.
I mean, I think there are people still excited for it, but I just think no one cares.
They put out a new trailer that I watched this week, and it was just like, okay, it's landing on planets, looking at space deer, and then flying into that. Like, it's like every trailer that they've ever put out has kind of been the exact same trailer.
Yeah.
Except this one had some like rock and roll music behind it. So.
Well, that's different.
Yeah. All right, and that is all the news that we have for this week. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to take a break. When we come back, we are going to answer your questions. Stick around! And we're back! John, we're back.
Yes.
We're back, John.
Uh-huh.
And before we get into the questions...
Hold on.
Okay.
I got to catch this Pikachu.
Get out.
Okay.
I'll do the rest of the podcast by myself.
We're good.
I'll do the rest of the podcast by myself.
I got him.
I'll talk to myself. I'll just do a John voice. I'll be like, oh, here's another thing. I'm John. Even though that's not what you sound like at all.
Yeah. It'd be better if, you know, if it was me doing an impersonation. You were like, I'm Jeff, and I'm the best person ever.
You know, it's funny because...
I'm the coolest. Look at me and my bald head and my beard.
I don't think any of those words have ever come out of my mouth, John.
It sounds exactly like you. I've been told by many people.
That's what if you ever meet me in real life, that's all I do is I just scream in a high-pitched voice how great I am.
No, that's like, how you sound normally.
Oh, okay.
You gotta remember, you sound differently to yourself, so when you hear someone else imitating you,
yeah,
it sounds like something completely different.
You know, actually, that's interesting. I haven't brought this up in an awful long time, but like you and I probably, it's one of those things where... out of all the, I could probably count myself in a growing minority, right? But a minority of people that exist in this world where when I hear my own voice, it doesn't sound weird to me because I've heard so much of my own voice.
Yeah, same here.
That it just doesn't mean anything to me. But before we go into the emails, I beat a game last week. So
oh my God!
Let's do a little review. Yeah, I'm.
It wasn't Tokyo Mirage Sessions, Effie, was it?
God, I'm 35 hours into that game, and I'm at the halfway point. But I'm just like, you want to know what the problem with Tokyo Mirage Sessions is? It's on the fucking Wii U. And I know that the Wii U is not the most powerful gaming system in the world. And I know that the Japanese aren't especially like sensitive to this sort of thing. But like, it just loads and loads and loads and like... It'd be one thing if, like, while it was loading, I could look at the text messages on my Wii U pad. But no, I can't. It's like, it's a very slow, slow, slow game. It's
what
good
game.
What
game did you beat, though?
Inside.
Oh, okay.
Last week, Inside from the makers of Limbo came out, and Joe and I played it for probably about 90 minutes total on the dojo. And I went ahead after he left and just went ahead and beat it. So Inside is the latest game by what's the name of that studio?
Oh, I have no idea.
The guys who made Limbo. And it's very, 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 very similar to Limbo. In that you start out, you're a young kid, you're a little boy, or I don't know, a little androgynous, whatever. You come out in a forest and like the world is out to get you. Play Dead, that's the name of the studio. the world's out to get you, and it's like a side-scrolling platformer where you can, I mean, basically, the tools at your disposal are run, jump, grab stuff, and that's pretty much it.
So basically the same tools you had in Limbo.
Very, very similar. In fact, the game is incredibly similar to Limbo. It's got a better, it's got a different art style where it's just more kind of like mono, it's a very flat color, kind of dim gray world, and it's a weird world that this kid stumbles into because... there's a lot of things that are trying to kill him, and it's never entirely clear like why the world is the way that it is. It's one of those games where it's like, you know, because at the beginning it's like you're walking around in the forest, and there's just like there's guys in pickup trucks running after you, like chasing you through the forest with Dobermans, right? That's some standard kind of like weird hillbilly stuff. But as you go on, there's like robots that'll shoot you. There's weird underwater Medusas that will try to kill you. There's like,
as they are wont to do.
There's this whole thing that is like, there are these zombies that you can control by putting on this helmet, and then you, like, you walk and the zombies walk around. And basically it's a puzzle game. You run around, you're trying to avoid death. It is a lot. It is almost, the gameplay is almost entirely the same as Limbo. It's been a while since I played Limbo, but it seems like it's just about the exact same thing as Limbo.
Okay.
You're running around, dark world, trying to solve stuff. It's very pretty. I mean, the game world itself is very beautiful, in a kind of weird dystopian way. Yeah. It doesn't explain anything at all. And then the ending is real strange, where there's a thing that happens and it doesn't really explain why that happens. There's also a secret ending that I looked up on YouTube, that also doesn't really explain anything. That's more of kind of like a meta thing. It's a real artsy fartsy kind of you know, what's going on, I don't know, but I'm just here for the experience type of thing. Now, as far as like whether or not a person should get this game, I thought it was a very fun game. It's about 3 hours if you're rushing. It's about 4 or 5 hours if you're trying to get everything in the entire game. But it is one of those games where once you've solved the puzzle, there's no, like, you're just going to go back. Like, if I was to play back through the game now, I could probably tear through it in, like, 2 hours because I know what every single puzzle is. I know the solution to every puzzle.
Okay.
They're not that difficult. And this is where I feel like a lot of people, this is going to be the dividing line for a lot of people. This game is $20. It's a 3 to 4 hour game that's $20 with virtually zero replay value. Now, what's there is an interesting experience if you're into that sort of thing. If you're into, like, I want to play something that's kind of like Limbo, it's cool. I can see it being a great, like, kind of rainy Sunday afternoon type of game. But it doesn't explain a lot. It's got a lot of unanswered questions. It's very vague and artsy. And it is, you know, 5 hours at maximum if you play through the entire game twice, maybe. So that's really, I feel like, going to be the big sticking point for people is... do you want to go, or like, do you consider this experience to be worth that amount of money? Kind of like the same. There's a lot of indie games that fall into that same category, right? Where it's like, this is an experience. You're going to play through it one time, and you're not ever going to have any real reason to play back through it again.
Like Gone Home.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. There's no real reason to play through Gone Home twice, because you already know everything that's going on. So that's Inside, and I liked it. Maybe I should go to that as well. Like,
yeah, you should actually tell us your thoughts on it.
I actually really did enjoy myself with the game while I was playing it. It does.
Did you feel it was worth the money you spent on it?
I do, but that's the thing is that, I mean, I know that there's a contingency of people out there who, like, any $60 video game that has less than 20 hours of gameplay, they consider that to be not worth it, right? That they want... they want the most bang for their buck out of a game. I enjoyed this, but then I like little artsy-fartsy, crapsy game like this. I think it's an interesting thing in the medium where we can tell these little stories, and they're interesting and fun, et cetera, et cetera. So I liked it, but I could definitely see... I almost feel like it should just be in the description of the game. Hey, this game is 3 hours long, and it's $20. Bada-bing, you know. Buy at your own peril. You know.
Okay.
So, all right. Well, with that, let's go ahead and jump into the questions. mail@rageselect.com is the email address. And we've got, I think our first question is actually kind of heavy.
A heavy one.
This first one comes in from Steven. And Steven says, hello, Jeff and John. You guys are probably flooded with questions about the recent shootings, which we're not. Which, by the way, I haven't really talked about the Dallas or any of that stuff. I have thoughts on that, but I generally try to keep that.
Yeah.
This show is about giving you, like, Pokemon Go. It's a way for you to laugh and at dick jokes. Not...
Yeah, it's we're making the funny so that you don't have to, we don't bombard you with the depressing shit.
Right. Anyway, Steve says, but let me ask you how I should deal with my coworkers who are racist/sexist. We had an argument over the recent events. One coworker believes that if you resist arrest in any way, your life is forfeit, and another believes it's black people's own fault for letting cops kill them. I can't fathom this bass ackwards thinking. Should I bring this up again on Monday? Sincerely, Steven. This is a heavy question.
I don't know how to answer that.
It's a very heavy question, Steven, because I don't know. Again, it's there's a part of me that's like, you're probably not going to change your coworkers' minds.
Yeah.
People in this particular debate, as near as I can tell from looking around and listening to what people were saying on the internet before I decided to go get drunk and play Tokyo Mirage Sessions, it doesn't seem like a lot of people are getting their minds changed. Now, yeah. That could just be looking at this stuff in a snapshot on a day where everybody's emotions were very high, and that if you look at it on a day where people are that there's more gradual change going on than there is people complaining about it, I don't really know. I guess here's just the question is, like, if somebody at your job makes a point or is constantly talking about things that you feel like fundamentally like in opposition to, do you confront them about it? Let's go over at a personal level first.
Are you talking about just me personally?
Yeah.
I typically don't talk about like that kind of stuff at work.
Yeah.
And like if like the conversation starts going that way, I kind of typically stop the conversation and go, look, I don't care what your belief is one way or another. I have to work with you every day. I don't want to know that shit.
Right.
I don't care if you agree with me or if I agree with you or if I don't agree with you, I would rather not know. I have to work with you every day.
Yeah.
I don't want, you know, just don't talk to me about it.
Right.
If you're going to talk about it, don't talk about it in earshot of me.
Yeah.
You know, that's not to be an asshole, but.
Yeah. I think I'm kind of on the same side because living in a perfect world, you should be able to have a dialogue with other human beings about what you do or you don't like in a civilized fashion. But when you're talking about it, your job, this is a source of income to you that you could be causing like a real serious issue with. And I don't know. It's hard for me to say that you should get up in your coworker's face and confront them or even try to reasonably confront them because the feelings that people have about these particular issues and a lot of issues in general right now are so strong that it's almost like I don't know if there's a way to have just a regular, reasonable conversation with somebody who holds diametrically opposed views to you. I mean, I guess it would depend on the person you're talking to, right?
Yeah. I mean, I've been very lucky in that, you know, despite the fact that I live in Texas, you know,
we live in Austin.
I live in Austin, but still I live in Texas.
Yeah.
You know, haven't had to deal with a lot of that.
Yes.
I mean, the most I've had to deal with is I had a friend on Facebook say something borderlining racist, and I just unfriended him.
Yeah.
Like, this is a guy I knew in high school and was, you know, was recently invited to a birthday party in which he wanted me to drive down to Houston for a LAN with a bunch of old friends that we used to LAN party with all the time.
Right.
And I wasn't going to go anyways, but it was just one of those things where it was just like, well, unfriend. Didn't tell him I unfriended him, just unfriended him.
Yeah.
Because he's like, you know what? I don't want that shit on my feed. And you're being vaguely racist. So
I honestly think that it's if you want to go about making a change for the better in the world, it's probably better to try to if you really do want to try to get because I'm not an expert on this. I'm really not. I just stay out of it. Right. I don't know if it's possible to change people's strongly held beliefs.
Yeah.
I think that you might, if you're looking to make a change for the better in the world, you might be better off trying to find people that have like more moderate stances on these things and then just try to kind of like gradually push them in a direction that you feel is more beneficial. Because I don't know that if you come across let's take a very extreme example here when it comes to racism, right? Like, I don't think that you're going to be able to talk a white supremacist out of being a white supremacist. Yeah. I don't know if there's any amount of emotion that you can throw at that person where there's not going to come a point where their brain just shuts down and they're not listening to you anymore. Which, and the other problem is, I mean, you know, it's one thing if you're at a bar, it's one thing if you're if you're at a group of, you know, if you're at a party or if you're with a group of people that, you know, whatever. But it's your job. I mean, you know, you're going to have to go back to your job.
Yeah.
And
yeah, I mean, for me personally, I'm very non-confrontational when it comes to places where I know I have to go back.
Yeah.
Like I typically don't talk about things that could lead to that. I don't talk about politics. I don't talk about don't talk about current events or anything like that. I don't talk about really anything.
Yeah.
At my job because I don't want any issues there.
Sure.
You know, now outside of work, yeah, sure. If someone, you know, gets in my face and is like, I fucking hate black people or I hate this thing, you know, I'll be like, hey, fuck you, you're racist, you know, kind of thing. And, you know, or I'll confront people about that outside of work, you know, but yeah, at work, you know, I and at work and at people with people that I work with, I typically try to not.
Yeah.
I'm very non-confrontational.
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe the best thing to do is to try to stay away from those people and then redirect your efforts towards places where, you know, I mean, I don't know. People in the comments can chime in and say, because in my opinion, I know that there are people who disagree with my opinion, but in my opinion, it's very infrequently that I've seen people that have super, again, super strong, ideas about, say, you know, gay rights or African-American people or the police or, you know, there's a bunch of topics where I feel like if a person feels too strongly about these, you're never going to reason them out of that opinion. You're never going to soften that opinion for them.
I mean, and I agree with you. And I do feel like that if you're like, I don't know, and I'm just saying like at a social setting and you're talking about to someone and someone's like, well, you know, it's these people brought it on themselves that this happened, or, you know, they say these like these, maybe they're not being like fully on, like, you know, I hate black people. They're right. Just saying, you know, they're just saying, well, you know, it's if they're going to protest, they're forfeiting their, you know, they're resisting arrest or whatever. They're basically, you know, regardless of what color they are, if they're resisting arrest, they're forfeiting their life as far as I'm concerned. Like, you know, comments like that.
Yeah.
Again, not in a works function, but if like you're in an out public, you know, like there is a conversation I feel like that can be had there. Yeah. Be like, whoa, you know, like why, you know, and then like, well, here's why that's wrong. Do you not see that? There is a conversation where you could actually talk to someone about that.
Yeah.
Again, not at work. Because again, like you said, because most likely if I'm in a social setting with that person and if I get to the point where it's clear it ain't going either way, like that we're just not ever going to be on the same page.
Yeah.
Like he can't convince me to be, to be borderline racist or whatever.
Right.
And I can't convince him to stop being it.
Right.
Then yeah, at that point go, well, I'm cutting you off. Like, I don't want to be around you anymore.
Right.
But at work, you can't do that.
Yeah.
You know, like you can. You know, some people be like, oh, report to your HR, you know, because they're being, you know, insensitive or whatever. But
see, that's also such a gamble, because if you do that and it doesn't work out and then it gets back that you got them in trouble with HR, like if HR gives them a warning and then it gets back that you're the one who, I mean, there's like, then there can be, this is why one of the reasons I hate working with other people who are, you know, there's no couches and microphones involved, right? Is there can be problems that come back at you. I don't know. I generally try to keep work.
Yeah, same here.
I don't want to date people I work with. I don't want to socialize with people that I work with. I mean, yeah, maybe like, oh, let's go out to happy hour, like, but not those racist assholes. But generally speaking, I go to work, do my job, come home, do the thing.
Ditto.
Yeah. So that's Steven, I wish I had. In a perfect world, I would love for you to be able to get up in the person's face and be like, here's all the reasons why you're wrong, and let me show you this, and let me tell you about this, and let me express my deeply held belief to you, and that person go, oh, I never thought about it like that, or like, oh, well, maybe I think maybe some of this, but not all of it, or blah, 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 blah. But in my experience, those sorts of beliefs tend to be so deeply held that you're never going to change anybody's mind. So, commenters, let Steven know what you think. So. And that, I believe, is the only heavy question we have for this week. So let's move on. This next one comes in from Alex. And Alex says, howdy, Jeff and John. Praise the dong. Recently, I was watching the Patreon playthrough for Dark Souls 1, and I thought to myself, I wish I could play that game again for the first time with all the exciting moments, the learning curve, frustration, and success, and shield up exploring new areas. Now, I've completed the game multiple times with various builds and playstyles, and we'll get to Anor Londo in a short time, which took me ages to get to on my first playthrough. The game is still fantastic, but I wish I could play it again for the first time. What game or games would you like to play again for the first time? Other than Dark Souls. Red Dead would be great. Also, please play Demon's Souls after Dark Souls on Patreon. I don't own a PS3 and I've always wanted to watch a playthrough. Also, when are we getting an HD console remaster of Dark Souls 1? 360 cannot handle Blight Town. It's actually strange seeing the detail in the enemies in Blight Town, as I've never really seen them because there have been jittery humanoid beings, and I usually use the master key and avoid them at all costs. Little patron from the land down under, praise the dong, Alex. Okay, so games that we wish we could play again for the first time. All of them. actually, that's not true. All of the good ones. I tell you what, man. Okay, so let's think down to some of those games where, like, they're never quite the same knowing what you know now of them. Portal is a great one.
Yeah, Portal's a good one.
To play. Portal and Portal 2 are both.
Yeah.
The first time you play through those, they're just like, I get to the end of Portal 2. when you I don't know why I'm talking around the end of Portal 2. When you shoot the moon,
yeah,
it's just like, holy shit. It was such a great little moment. That and, you know, in Portal 1, the first when you escape the death and suddenly it's like, oh shit, you get this whole other game going on.
Yeah.
Let's see.
I'm trying to think if there's anything that I specifically would just be like, oh man, if I could go back and play that for the first time and experience it the way that I experienced it the first time.
Yeah.
Games
with big old twists in them. I mean, I probably put most of Metal Gear on there. There was, you know, like, especially the bosses in, like, say, Snake Eater, that I'm like, I've got them down now, right? Or, well, I sort of. I mean, the playthrough that Jason and I did will speak otherwise about that. But those are great. Those are great. It's a great. I wish that I could actually experience the Metal Gear franchise for the first time all together, right? Playing them all back to back.
Yeah.
Because I played them all as they came out. So that'd be nice if you could just sit down and, like, go through all of Metal Gear without
and this also goes to Patreon. How did experiencing my first playthrough, full playthrough of Metal Gear Solid 1 with me,
you should see the shit eating grin on John's face.
Did that make it feel like you were playing it for the first time?
No, it made me want to rip my lips off and shove them into my eyes so I didn't have to watch anymore or talk.
On Patreon, folks.
No, that's why I don't even, I like, there's a part of me that doesn't even understand the phenomena of Let's Plays, because when I watch somebody else play a game and they're watching terribly at it, it's just like I scratch the deep red lines into my face of just go left.
So it's basically everyone watching our playthroughs.
Yes, exactly. Which is, again, why I don't know how people can fucking stand to watch us play video games, because it's like, I know that there's some of you out there that are still yelling at the screen. I understand why you're yelling at the screen. Still can't hear you. Let's see. I'm trying to think of some of the games, some games that were really, like, emotionally affecting. I'm trying to think of some of the things. Skyrim was a real revelation, you know, when I first played it. That was one that I wish I could kind of go back and experience again for the first time. Just kind of the big, beautiful open world that they had. You know, if I could erase my memories of Modern Warfare and play that Modern Warfare remaster with no knowledge of where the story is actually going, I think Modern Warfare has an excellent, excellent storyline. Let's see. I mean, you literally just pick the best games that are out there, and I'd love to be able to play them again.
Yeah, but I mean, I kind of agree with that.
I was going to say Persona 4, but then, because I've been having a hankering for Persona 4 recently, I think Tokyo Mirage Sessions is kind of getting my Persona hackles up. But the thing is that I don't think I need to have a memory wipe for Persona 4, because since it was 60 hours long, I'm sure there are details in the middle of that game that I've just completely fucking forgotten about. Yeah.
Also, Persona 5 is going to be coming out.
Yeah.
Sometime in the near future.
Next year.
It's next year.
Yeah. Let's see. Super Metroid.
I was going to say, actually, no, not Super Metroid, but I was going to say Resident Evil 4.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, that's a good one. Didn't exactly have a super big twist in it, but it's a real fun game.
Yeah, but it was just like the joy. I mean, even Resident Evil as well. I mean, like, actually, you know, the Resident Evil's 1, 2, and 4. Mm-hmm. Let's forget about 3.
Why? Is it bad?
I didn't like
it. Is Root. Nemesis bad?
It's actually not considered bad. I don't personally care for it.
Did you play
it,
Code Veronica?
No, I never played Code. Oh.
Never played that either.
But
Assassin's Creed 2 go with that. I mean, yeah, it's pretty much just like sort all the video games by what's the best out there, and then I mean, I think that the games that have a real big nifty twist to them are probably best for that category.
Yeah, I'm sure some people would say BioShock.
Oh yeah, BioShock. Oh man, so Matt and I have been playing BioShock Infinite for Sequential Saturday, and I was so. I was so into it because we did a big front loading batch before he left because he's going to be out for a little while. And I went back and played the DLC for BioShock because I'm like, oh, I don't want to play further into Infinite, but I'll go back and play the Burial at Sea stuff. That's great. The Burial at Sea was real great. I really enjoyed that.
Yeah, I think I bought the Burial at Sea like season pass or the season pass to get that.
Yeah.
I don't think I ever played it.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, it's so
good. I played the first one.
There's a big twist at the end of the first one.
Yeah, I don't think I played the second one though.
Actually, it's the second one is interesting. You know, spoiler alert for a game that's been out for a long time. But you play as Elizabeth in the second one, and you don't have a shield, so it's a lot more like stealth oriented. Because even like the pistol that you have, it's like she can shoot it, and then she has to like cock it. Like she has to use both hands to cock another shot in it. So it takes a lot longer. So there's actually like a couple of new tonics that like there's one that lets you like be invisible and see enemies through walls at the same time, which is really cool.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know. Pick a thing. Any big experiential game.
Alan Wake.
Braid. I'd like to be able to play Braid again without knowing stuff about it. Hell, Uncharted. I'd love to be able to erase my knowledge of Uncharted and play the Uncharted collection from start to finish. So those are real fun games. Anyway, all right, so our next question comes in from Daniel, who says, hello, Jeff and John. Have y'all ever had a favorite game of yours get ruined by the player community, no matter if it's multiplayer or single player? I've had a few ruined by toxic multiplayer like the original Counter-Strike or DayZ. Recently, I had to take a break from Overwatch because I'm running into more trolls, dickheads, and or armchair generals on it that is killing my experience. Even if I turn off voice chat, it's the same reason I avoid MOBAs like the plague. Thanks and take care, Daniel.
I'm pretty sure there have been, and I honestly couldn't tell you off the top of my head.
Okay.
Like, I know that there have been that, like, just the multiplayer or, you know, the community for it just fucking ruined that game.
Yeah.
But for the life of me, I couldn't tell you what it is.
I remember back in the old days when I played Counter-Strike, when it was still in beta, Counter-Strike was kind of nasty, like the voice chat, you know, you're just running into randos on the internet. I will not play a Call of Duty game with voice comms turned on.
Yeah, I don't. I typically don't either.
The last time I think I tried to do that was in Ghosts, and I literally had some guy screeching at me and calling me a noob fag and talking about my mom and stuff like that. And I was just like, dude.
You don't know my mom. She's a nice lady.
Dude, you need to, like, it's just like you're taking this way too seriously.
Yeah.
You're taking it way too seriously. Like, because his problem was that I was standing too close to him and that I was such a faggy noob that, like, I was going to get him killed because...
Oh, I would have started just standing next to him all the time.
Well, I just turned off my microphone. I was just like, well, I don't need to hear you anymore. Yeah, I don't know. I'll tell you what. The Dark Souls community... the whole get good thing.
Yeah.
I fucking hate that shit.
Oh, no, it is. It's fucking terrible.
I hate that. Like, I hate that so much because, like, you have people that want to get into this phenomenon.
It's an asshole way of saying what actually needs to be done. Because really, for Dark Souls, it's like, well, you have to learn to play it better.
The thing that irritates me about it is not necessarily what you said. It's that... whenever a person is asking for help in Dark Souls, there are literally 1 million things that you could tell them. You can explain the upgrade system. You can explain how to get to this place. You can explain how this boss is weak to this thing. You can explain, oh, if you take a shield, you buff it like this, then you'll nullify most of the damage from that boss. You could be like, you need to upgrade your stamina. You need a medium roll for this boss. You need a light roll for this boss. You could tell them anything, and... it would be better advice than get good, than just be better at... It's like if anybody asked your advice, oh, man, I'm having trouble with my girlfriend. What should I do? Be better. Be better at life. Like, it's so terrible.
That is what I tell people when they ask me for relationship advice. It's like, well, be a better person.
Yeah.
Just be better at everything.
John is infinitely amused by the fact that my dog is having little dog dreams.
Well, it's not so much that he's woofing or having dog dreams. It's the sound he's making because it's not like an actual like woof. It's like woof.
Well, it's basically
like you could record those sounds and it would like you and then like make them as like sound effects for like spaceships flying through space.
Well, it's
like some science sci-fi engine going whoop 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 whoop.
It's barking with his mouth closed. Yeah, that's what he's doing.
It is.
I think
it's adorable.
I think we were talking about him. I don't know. He may still be asleep.
No, he's still asleep.
My favorite part is when he starts growling in his dreams. That's my favorite. But yeah, and then the MOBA community too is. I don't know. I've never really gotten into it.
I can't.
Heroes of the Storm. But.
Yeah, I will say the MOBA community is like one. The community itself has made me like it's weird because there's a part of the community that's actually like really good and actually like, oh, hey, you know, like I want you're into MOBAs. Cool. Here's kind of how to, you know, let's help you.
Sure.
There is a large portion of the MOBA community that is like, cool, I want to share my experience with you. I want to share. But then there's also this other portion of it that's like, you don't know how to fucking play the game, you fag.
But here's the thing is that unlike a lot of other games, I feel like in MOBAs, I can understand that more because one weak player in a MOBA can lose you the match.
Yeah, but how the fuck am I supposed to get good at the match if I can't play the game?
No, I understand that. I totally understand that. I totally understand.
Like, it's a catch 22. It's like I have to start playing the game knowing everything there is to know about this game.
Right.
Where that's just not even physically fucking possible.
Yep. Well, not only that, but you're going to need to poorly play 50 to 100 matches just to learn how bad you are at the game before you can actually start getting better. So. All right. Anyway, our next one is coming in from Miro, who says, hey, Jeff and John, I don't have much time to watch your gaming videos, and I sometimes doze off during the gaming news segment of the podcast. Aw. But I love weird stories and movie/TV pop culture rants, and I definitely want to hear more. So keep the good work and let your mouth run free. Anyway, here's the question. I do my gaming on a budget. I've never had a console. I buy games on Steam or GOG during sales when they drop below €5. That means waiting a few years after a release, but I get all the patches, DLC, and even my mediocre PC can play the game with the highest detail settings. However, I'm thinking about buying a PS4 for exclusives and VR. Is it possible to do the same thing on a PC and get older games very cheap? Or am I missing the point of the console business that you save on hardware but pay extra for games? Thanks, and rage on, Miro.
Sort of.
It's harder.
Yeah.
Like during E3, Sony had a big old sale.
And right after E3, Microsoft even had one as well. Like the week that the Sony E3 sale ended, Microsoft started up their summer sale or whatever.
Yeah. They do have them, and when you get stuff, you can get amazing things. Like I said, I thought about if you have a PlayStation Plus subscription on the PS4 during that post E3 sale. Like I said, Star Wars Battlefront was like $7 or something like that. It was something ridiculous. And if you have PlayStation Plus, you'll get a bunch of further discounts on things.
And if you have PlayStation Plus, you'll also get at least two free games every month with that. I shouldn't say two free, but you get two games every month.
You get two games for the PS4, two for PS3, two for Vita.
Yeah.
But yeah, there are sales. They're less frequent. Like Steam has stuff on sale all the fucking time.
Yeah. And they also have like multiple, Steam sales a year. Like I think there's like one at the beginning of the year, one in the middle of the year, one at the end of the year, and maybe two more somewhere in between those for good measure.
Right.
So, I mean, it's...
You just have to keep an eye on it.
Yeah.
Like, it's not as easy, and it's not as big of a thing. Like, there have been some Sony flash sales that have just passed me by.
Yeah.
Where it's like, oh, flash sale this weekend. Everything from this publisher is on sale for $10 or less.
Yeah.
So, yeah. If you get a PS4 and you keep an eye on it, there definitely are sales.
Games do drop in price. Like, I mean, you can like a lot of people who are on console games are like, oh, that's a game I want to play, but I'm not going to spend $60. I'm going to wait till next year when I pay $40 and I get all the DLC with it for that $40.
I think I was showing Matt when the PS4 sale was going on. I think like Black Flag, Assassin's Creed Black Flag, was like $10 or something like that.
Well, it was like, what was it? Saints Row 4 on the sale was like $5.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yep. So, yeah, they're definitely out there, but you definitely, I feel like it's less frequent, so you need to make sure to take advantage of it when you can.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Our next one comes in from Justin, who writes his emails in incredibly teeny tiny font. And he says, "Hey, Jeff and John, I was looking up the history of Fire Emblem recently, since it was fresh on the mind due to its most recent release. As I was going through the wiki page, I ran across a small section at the bottom that talks about how Nintendo filed 3 lawsuits against a former employee that started his own company, Tiernanog. The lawsuit was filed on the basis that Nintendo believed the game that was being created by Tiernanog, originally titled Emblem Saga, later changed to Tier Ring Saga, was too similar to their Fire Emblem IP. This took me aback because when I think of Nintendo, I think of happy-go-lucky, except if you plan on let's playing their games. I understand they're a company and they have to protect their IPs, but suing 3 times and only being successful on their second attempt on a former employee seems a bit much. Are there other cases that come to mind about big gaming companies suing former employees that was kind of swept under the rug like this one was? I'm guessing it would have probably had to have been before the social media age that we are in today. Thanks for reading my question. Justin." Well, first off, Justin, I can tell you that Nintendo is a fairly litigious company.
Yeah, if you try to use their IP, they'll come after you.
Not only that, but I mean, you know, they were more aggressive about going after like emulator websites and people that were supplying ROMs, because part of it could also be, you know, I learned a little bit back, I should say, everybody else probably already knew it, back when Blizzard was doing their thing with that server that was running vanilla WoW, that, like, there's a certain case where you have to protect your intellectual property.
Yes.
If you don't, if a company can show that you do not aggressively protect your intellectual property, you can actually lose parts of your right to it if you don't.
I can actually give a really good example of that. Well, actually, no. I can't.
Okay,
but Dawn of the Dead, not Dawn of the Dead, but the original Night of the Living Dead. Mm-hmm. It's different because they didn't put a copyright logo on the poster for it. But now any company can release a movie called Night of the Living Dead because
it's public domain.
It's now public domain because they didn't copyright the name. That's why you actually can find a shit ton of Night of the Living Dead movies and Night of the Living Dead sequels that have nothing to do with Night of the Living Dead.
Nintendo, when you say I think of Nintendo as a happy-go-lucky company, I think of Nintendo as a weirdly stodgy, litigious organization that manufactures fun very well.
Disney.
Yeah, exactly.
Nintendo and Disney share a lot in common.
Yeah, we're like, you probably don't want to ever try to cross them because it's not like Mario is sitting in the boardroom of Nintendo like, "Hey, it's me. Let's make some games. That'll be so fun." They're like, "All right, we need 60% more fun by the fourth quarter. Put out Pokemon Go. Release it to the public now." As far as other lawsuits, probably the most high-profile one was Weston Zampella over at Activision getting fired, and then the ensuing kind of royalty battle over the royalties for, Modern Warfare 3? They were fired during the development of, right after the release of Modern Warfare 3.
Yeah.
And then it was one of those things where it's like Activision said that they were shopping another property around, and they said that they weren't, and then Activision said that that was grounds for dismissal and then for them to be able to take away the royalties that they would have gotten or whatever, and they left and they took like half the studio with them over to EA and made Respawn Entertainment. But that case was in court for a while. Yeah.
Well, even more recent, the dude that had to do with Ark, Survival Evolved, it was the dude who apparently worked for... I think he worked for Ubisoft or Activision or something.
Yeah.
And he like worked over there and then like while he was still employed by them, he was apparently consulting with his wife and some other guy started up the company that made Ark Survival Evolved.
Right.
And like there was rumors that a lot of assets that that this guy was making a lot of assets or helping them with code and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And like they were even like looking at the code of the game going, no, this is totally him. And he's like, no, I just consulted. I didn't actually work for them.
Right.
While I was employed for you. And it was just like, no, you totally worked on that game. You just used your wife to do it.
What was the other one when Carmack went over to Facebook and ZeniMax?
Yeah, they said he took a lot. Yeah, they said he took a lot of assets to go work on something for,
or that he was working on stuff for VR for them, and that he couldn't use any of that over at Facebook or something like that. There have been a few. There's also a pretty classic one that I don't think a lot of people remember, and I'm sorry that I don't have the details for any of this. Was the Nintendo was in a lawsuit for, like, what was it, like 5 or 10 years over Rumble?
Oh, yeah.
Over the guy who originally created, or at least, I don't know if there was a patent troll or what it was, but, like, somebody said a rumbling controller, I came up with that, I was making it, Nintendo ripped it off, and that it took them a long time. And I think they actually settled with the guy, didn't they? Did they pay him?
I think so, probably.
Some amount of money? But yeah, I mean, there's been a few over there over the years.
I mean, wasn't that part of the reason that Sony, when the PS3 first came out, the controller didn't have any type of rumble on it?
Oh yeah, the dumb six axis where they're like, we don't need rumble, you can do blah blah blah.
Which I think it was like they tried to claim that it would mess with the actual six axis controls, and then they were like, no, we don't need it. And then when people complained about it too much, they released a six axis with.
Didn't they was Sony in that rumble lawsuit as well? Did they?
I think they might have. Yeah.
Okay. There's been some stuff over the years. My favorite, though, it's worth bringing up. Okay, I might have to stop the podcast for a second just to find this guy's name. Who's the guy who, like, if you want to use the word
Edge?
Yeah, who's that guy?
Oh, I don't know his name, but yeah, no, I know what you're talking about.
Oh man, okay,
it's
so
like
there's
anyone
this...
who wanted to use the word Edge in anything.
Yeah,
like I didn't even like Mirrors. He sued EA for Mirror's Edge. Probably sued WWE for the wrestler named Edge.
Yeah, it's this guy, Edge Games, and this is Tim Langdell. And let's see. Yep. He basically went out. He was this guy that was known for a long time of, like, he created this thing called Edge Games. And if you use the word Edge in the title of your game or anywhere kind of near it, he would basically bring a lawsuit against you. Yeah. As far as I could tell, this company's never actually put out a game. He's a developer. Let's see. 1990. Oh, no. The time, property of his Softex software. Softex catalog includes Fairlight, Garfield, Big Fat Hairy Deal, released in 1987. Mirrors, Mithras 2. I don't think this company's ever put out a game, John.
Yeah.
I don't think that they've actually ever released a game. That they've just spent all their time bringing lawsuits against people who use the word Edge.
Yeah.
So they're one of my favorites because it's just some sad guy in California like, no, you can't use the word Edge. Honestly, if I tried to name this website Edge Select, he probably would have.
Yeah, I think he also like sued Activision for Spider-Man Edge of Time.
Oh, yeah.
And like literally any title that had the word Edge somewhere in the title, he filed a lawsuit.
Yeah. And let's not forget our most recent example of that kind of garbage lawsuit when King tried to bully Banner Saga because it had the word Saga in it. Go fuck yourself, King.
Well, there was also the time that Bethesda tried to sue a company for using the word Scrolls.
Oh, Scrolls. Yeah. No, it was Mojang. Yeah. Mojang created that Scrolls game and Bethesda tried to get up on them about that. But that some of those also, though, I wonder, like if the King software thing was another one of those, like, because you have to, like, they probably, I mean, I hate that company because, well, there's also that whole other guy that they probably ripped off and made that Candy Crush thing or made whatever that other game was. Yeah. But you got to wonder if you're King Software and you're making Candy Crush Saga and you've got hundreds of people trying to rip it off on iOS, whether you just basically do a search for video games with the word Saga in it and just start sending out lawsuit emails.
Yeah.
Because you're on iOS, right? And you're going to have like, oh, Sweet Tooth Saga. Oh, you know, Candy Bar Saga, right? Like a bunch of people making garbage knockoff games that are trying to get in on your same thing. Not that I think that King is a good company.
No, they're not.
Fuck them. Fuck them. They got, what, did EA buy them or was it Activision?
I think it was EA.
All right, we got a couple more questions, then we're going to be done. Next one comes in from VJ, who says, hello, Priest of the Dong, VJ here. Today I need to rant about Microsoft pulling a dick move. I've recently received an email from Microsoft informing me that from August onward, my OneDrive storage will be reduced from 30 gigabytes to a measly 5 gigabytes, which means that the 25 gigabytes of complimentary OneDrive storage that I received from purchasing one of their flagship Lumia phones is essentially gone. Now I have to find a way to delete 5 gigabytes of pictures because camera auto upload was on for 2 years, since it is a convenient way to access all my pictures from any computer. I feel cheated because it was a big selling point for the phone, and they just yanked it away after a few years. Needless to say, I will not be I will not be buying a Windows phone next because Windows 10 is absolute garbage, and Google offers 15 gigabytes for free. Therefore, Microsoft can go suck a dick. Have any of you guys had this experience where you were loyal to a company and they pulled some crap that made you turn away from them? Thanks for answering my question, and rage on, BJ. Well, sure. My most recent example has to be having to pay my internet service provider an additional $50 every month because they decided to do the dumb bandwidth cap horse shit. Yeah. Where they're like, oh, and, which is, I buy the most expensive package from AT&T UVerse so I can upload, download, and stream and do stuff like that. And they were like, oh, man, you get 12 gigabytes a month. And I'm like, bitch, I do 12 gigabytes in a day. I looked at my upload and download statistics for a month of Rage Select,
yeah,
it's a terabyte. It's like you get 12 gigs and then you get, you know, you can buy another 50 for, or another 10 or something for like $12 over. I did the math and it was like, it would have cost me like triple if I just bought as needed.
Yeah.
So I had to basically, you can get cable with them, which will make you, you get it unlimited for free, or you can spend an additional like 40 or 50 bucks for this like overage thing. So that you have unlimited. And it's like, what a fucking ass move. What a shit ass move is that?
You know what that is?
What's that?
It's them battling cord cutters, who base people who don't want cable, who are then buying Netflix and Hulu and all, you know, Crunchyroll and all these other streaming services and just don't use. It's them trying to figure out a way to bilk you out of that money that they just lost because you're not paying for cable anymore.
It makes perfect sense. But yeah, they can go fuck themselves.
Oh, I'm not saying it's right. I'm just saying that's exactly the reason they're doing it.
Jesus Lord, monkey balls. Like, Google Fiber is taking its fucking sweet goddamn time getting up here. I want
Good
my Google
God
Fiber.
It is.
Like, it's not even, they're not even, like, they're just creeping forward at a snail's pace. I'm like, I'm going to be double old by the time they get up here. I'm going to be like a million years old.
Might even be triple old.
Oh, shit. I'll be what, triple my age? 190, let's see, 106? Yeah.
So you got triple 106 because that's your current?
Yeah, that's my current age. Okay. I'll be 318. So
900 years old you reach, look as good, you will not.
That's right. That's right. That's why I shaved my head. You saw what's going on the top of Yoda's head.
Yeah.
That was a bad comb over. I don't know. Do you have any, like, the company fucked me out of a thing? I kind of feel a little let down by the fact that we no longer live in an era of $5 footlongs. So I'm not going back to Subway. I'm not paying $7 for one of their garbage sandwiches.
I mean, there was a kind of a customer service experience kind of situation where I got pissed off and stopped shopping at Fry's Electronics for like 10 years.
Oh, fuck them.
For like 10 full years.
Go fuck them so hard. Go and then, tell your story, please.
Oh, no. I was back when I was living in Houston, and I worked an overnight shift at a company, and there was a Fry's across the street, and there was one night where I was like, oh, I'm going to go in and buy a game for my laptop. You know, it's cool. I'm at work. You know, I have my laptop with me and I'm playing it, and I'd lock my car up and went inside, and, you know, there's cameras everywhere. Sure. So I'm like, fuck it. You know, it's great. Go in, literally was inside for maybe like 15 minutes, come out, car's broken into and everything.
Oh, damn.
And they basically were like, well, you know, yeah, we have cameras, but we didn't catch anything on the camera, because I'm literally like right in front of the doors, like my car is like, you walk outside the door, there's my car.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how did no one see this? And apparently, because they're loading docks in the back, their people don't like to use them. They parked a giant fucking semi truck right in front of the entryway, blocking all of the security cameras, which then someone used to break into my car and like three other cars.
Blah.
And then they just went, well, you know, it's your own fault.
Blah.
You shouldn't have had that stuff in your car.
That's okay, that story is way better than my Fry
story.
And I
basically was like, had they been like, hey, man, I wish, like, had the customer service part of it been like, okay, this is our bad.
Yeah.
We can't do anything for you.
Yeah. But sorry.
Let us work with you. Let's get a cop. Let's call. Let's get them out there so we can do a police report. Let me help you as much as I can.
Right.
Because of something that we did that ended up causing you to get robbed.
Yeah.
Instead, they're like, we're not at fault. Get the fuck out. And I was just like, well, go fuck yourself, and refused to shop there for years.
Yeah.
Like, the only reason I ended up shopping there is because, A, I moved to a different city.
Right.
And B, I forget what it was, but it was actually something where I needed something. Like, I had it was one of those things where I had to buy a keyboard or something. And it was like, I had to have it, like, right then and there. And the closest place that sold keyboards was Fry's.
Yeah.
And I just didn't have the time to go to someplace further away.
Yeah.
So I was just like, fuck it, went in, bought a keyboard, and left. Like, since then I maybe shopped there like once or twice, but it's like I don't really shop there all that often because their stores suck.
I gave it up. Like, there's actually, I mean, you know, I buy games every single week, right? And there is a Fry's right down the street. I will never shop there ever again. Well, first of all, I worked for them, which is garbage because they require you. Oh, man. You know, any place that requires you to wear dress shoes and then the floor of that place is just like uncovered white marble, like, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you. I worked in the service department for a little while, and it's just like my feet were always destroyed. But anyway, the problem that I have with Fry's is that I went there one day to buy a game, and the game that I wanted, and this will tell you how long it's been, was Full Spectrum Warrior for the PC. And I went in, and I walked over to the game place, and I looked through all the games, and I looked at it, and it wasn't there. And I walked up to the little game counter, and I was like, hey, did you guys not put out Full Spectrum Warrior yet? Because that came out. And they were like, well, when did it come out? And I was like, today. And they're like, we don't have games the day a game comes out. I'm like, why not? And they're like, well, we just don't. We'll probably get them in on Friday. I'm like, oh, okay. So I actually waited, and then I went back on Friday, and I was like, one Full Spectrum Warrior, please. And they're like, oh, no, we didn't get them on. We didn't get them. And it was just the nonchalant way that they were like, what? Why would we have a video game in the video game department? And I'm like, because it's the video game department, and you sell video games? Plus, there came a time where, you know, there was a time early on where Fry's cut prices to the point that where they were competitive as far as electronics go. And now, fuck you, Amazon.
There was a time where they actually did really good prices. And also, their stuff, like their DVD section, their video game sections were very organized, and you could find what you were looking for without even really trying. And then just over time, they started caring less and less about it.
Yeah.
Like, especially the one over here by us, where, like, their DVDs aren't even organized. Like, they're just like, oh, they're just there. I literally, it was like, where's your new release section? Oh, we got rid of that.
Yeah.
Why would you get rid of your new release section?
Yeah, exactly that. Exactly that of like, you know, oh, well, I don't know. It's almost like they feel like, oh, well, you pay 5% less here. So if you don't like it, you go somewhere else. And the problem with places like that is that, like, there's an internet. And you know what? Like, it used to be that if I wanted to get a thing, I could either wait for a few weeks for it to ship by Newegg, or I could probably go get it for the same price as Fry's. But after Fry's dicked me enough, it's just like, nah, I'm just going to buy it over the internet. I'll wait. I'll just Amazon Prime next day shipping.
Yeah.
I'll pay a little bit extra. Fuck it. Because I'm just not dealing with you anymore. GameStop was like that back when they used to do that thing where if you tried to go in and buy a game the day it came out, they were just like, well, if you didn't pre-order it, we don't have any copies of it.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah.
They finally cut that shit out, and it was like, all right.
I actually remember, what was it? We went to go buy a game. I can't remember what game it was. I think it was like Luigi's Haunted Mansion for the 3DS or something. I had pre-ordered it at GameStop, and we went in because I had gotten a call saying, oh, yeah, it's going to be here tomorrow. Come on in, and we'll have it for you. And I come in like, oh, hey, you shouldn't have been called because we didn't get any copies. It didn't get released. I was like, what? And they're like, no stores got it. There was a truck breakdown. There are zero stores in Austin that have this game. And I'm like, oh, that's fucked up. You know, at first I'm like, okay, that's weird, but hey, if no stores have it, no stores have it. You know, they said that there was a truck that broke down.
Sure.
No stores got it.
The
whatever.
Luigi truck, the one truck that had.
Well, it was just like all the delivery trucks. No stores. They're like, yeah, people have been coming over here from Best Buy and from Target, upset that they didn't have any, and find out we don't have any.
Yeah.
And so it's like no one got them apparently, like due to this whatever. I'm like, all right, well that's cool, whatever. Walk next door because we're bored and walk next door to Target. They have like 20 copies of it.
Yep.
So we just bought it, walked back. I was like, hey, can I move my pre-order to something else? And they're like, why? And I was like, because I just bought this game over at Target next door to your fucking store after you told me that they didn't have that no one had the game.
Yep.
And they were like, oh, but no one did have the game as far as we knew. I was like, well, then if you don't know for sure, don't fucking tell me that.
Yep. 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 All right. We got one more question. This one, I believe, was written whilst a person was intoxicated. So I'm going to read it and then try to translate as much as humanly possible. It says, Dear Ragelight, I might be drifting into me RP dwarf for now, but my question still stands, lads and lasses. What other game franchises other than Dark Souls have brought you to tears during the final boss? I loved finding out just who the Souls of Cinder was and how much I teared up over a certain set of piano keys. Yes, I tend to fall into one of my RP characters when I've liquored up. There are far worse things to do when visited by the gin goddess, but I be digressing me pint now, and that's nay good for your podcast. Gone far off the deep end with me rambling. Sorry about that, laddie, but there'd be no gyms around for me to be filling my belly out to set off the booze. Hoping to be a Patreon subber within the next few weeks. Your wow RPer, Tristan.
See, you got to read that in a voice, man. You gotta,
I
like,
know.
I might be drifting into my RP dwarf for now, but my question still stands, lads and lassies.
Yeah, I'm not,
you know, you gotta get into it. You gotta read, because I mean, I'm reading that, and that's all I'm hearing is like, what other game franchises other than Dark Souls have? You know, that's all I'm.
I'll
hearing
do robot.
In my head.
I'll do robot voice.
That's what you did. That's essentially what you did.
I be drifting into me RP dwarf. Anyway, so what game franchises have brought you to tears? What do you think, John? Answer. It's manly cries.
Here's the thing. I've had some manly cries. I'll totally admit that. I don't know if I've ever cried for a video game, though. That's the weird thing. I feel like there is one game, like there is a game that has emotionally just like struck me at my core.
Yeah.
And I can't for the life of me think of what it is.
Okay.
I know there's tons of movies, tons of comic books, and things like that that have done that.
But not games.
I can't think of a video game that has actually brought me to like to have tears in my eyes and things like that.
I've said this before, but Metal Gear Solid 4 totally done that. There's the end boss fight between Snake and Ocelot that actually goes through, like, you actually fight Ocelot like four times, and the health bars and the music change and the fighting style changes to be the end fight of Metal Gear Solid 1, 2, 3,
yeah,
and one finally for 4. And it's kind of just this, like these two old men at the end of their ropes, and the conflict has been resolved, but they're just still fighting because that's all that they know, which is what was really emotionally affecting to me the first time that I saw it. I'm trying to think of other games that got me all teary-eyed at the end. I'm trying to think. Red Dead. I don't know if I went all full tears, but the end of Red Dead.
Yeah.
It was kind of like, whoa.
I knew it was coming.
Yeah.
But yeah, I totally get that one.
Let's see. Portal and Portal 2's endings. I just got Portal in the brain today. Probably got some emotional sports out of me. Yeah.
All that Portal VR.
Yeah. I just got to play the one where you
pull Atlas apart. Yeah, no, I'm just saying, because it's infested your brain.
That's what it is.
Because it was in VR.
Yeah. It's my only defense against Pokemon Go, against the brainworms of Pokemon Go, is Portal.
Yeah.
Really emotional video games. Really emotional games. Okay, I'm going to have to cheat, you guys. I'm going to the internet. I'm trying to think if there's been like a Zelda that did that. I don't know that I...
You know what? I'll actually say, thinking about it, Journey.
Okay.
That actually was pretty emotional.
Mm-hmm. Wow, this is the Prima Games 50 Biggest Emotional Moments in Video Games.
Numbers 40 through 41.
Number 40 through 40,
31.
31. Nope. Nope.
He's literally just scrolling through these like, no. Yeah.
No.
I don't think it was a crying emotion, but Gone Home was kind of emotional.
This is all right. How do I get to the next page of this?
I don't think there's a page. I think they just posted articles.
There they are.
Yeah.
Let's go 10 through 1. Let's see if the internet can answer where we can't. Walking Dead. I didn't
actually finish Walking Dead.
Yeah, I didn't do that.
Shadow of the Colossus was pretty emotional.
Oh, no, but see, you see which one it is. It's not the end of Shadow of the Colossus. It's when Argo falls off the edge of the cliff. Yes, I can tell you that I did not cry, but I was like, what do you mean? And I thought that had happened because I had missed the jump. So I literally went back and reloaded my game and tried it like a second time. I mean, we just had shit twice in a row. And I was like, oh, man.
Yeah.
Man. They got Joel's daughter dies. That never really. Maybe I'm just a cold hearted snake, but that just didn't.
Well, I feel like these are just like these are things that provoked emotions, not necessarily.
Oh, that's a good one. The Metroid, when the baby Metroid comes in to save you. At the end of Metroid. Let's see what these ones are. BioShock Infinite. You know, Portal 2. I already said that. Star Wars. Death of Sniper Wolf. Heavy Rain, Silent Hill 2. Yeah, I'm not getting much out of this. These are just emotional moments, but
not necessarily like tearful moments.
Not sad moments. I don't know. I'm sure that if I thought about it, I could probably find maybe a little bit more. Oh no. Okay. Mass Effect 3, when Morten Solis got killed, I was like, cuz he's my favorite.
Yeah.
He was my favorite. The GTA 4, when they kill off your favorite character, that one was a little anyway, but I figure that's enough. It's weird how video games, I don't think it's a problem with me. I don't think it's my cold robot heart, because I learned to simulate human emotion a long time ago. I think that it's more that video games tend more towards passionate anger than they do towards sadness like that, or tragedy. In a way that is so well put together that it really kind of hits you in the guts, right? I think it just has to do a lot with the storytelling medium.
Yeah.
Anything else come to mind while I was yammering on about whatever dumb shit?
Not anything else, not really.
No? All right. Well, hey, listeners, why don't you put your most cryful moments down in the comments below? Because with that, we're done.
Hey!
It's another podcast done. Mail at ragesite.com is the email address. Hey, be sure to write in if you come up with a question. I had almost didn't have enough questions this week, John. I hate to have to ask people for questions. So mail at ragesite.com is the email address. Now, if you all will excuse me, John, I'm going to need to see your phone for just a second.
No.
Just a second.
I got to go hunt a Psyduck.
No, I got to see your phone.
There's
for
a Psyduck
second.
Nearby.
No, I'm going to need your phone.
I Psyduck.
I have to throw it.
I have to
bury it in the back.
No, there's a Psyduck over here.
You and Psyduck can go to hell.